Well, hello, friends. Hello, folks. Welcome back to what I have chosen to call a history of rock and roll in film and rock and roll. You may call it what you like. And today we are rounding out a three-part series on The Deadpool and Guns N' Roses with a couple of really big, big in-depth stretches of storytelling. And it's going to come from a couple of different people. One of them is going to be an exploration of the whole Get in the Ring saga. And that's going to be, I think, the main chunk of this that strays away from the 80s. I covered a lot of early 90s Guns N' Roses stuff with the Faith No More episode that involved them and Soundgarden. You can look back in my history for that in the feed. Now, we're going to be a bit light on the Dirty Harry content, unfortunately. obviously, if you've listened to the Vanishing Point episode, which is what's tied in with the previous Guns N' Roses saga, as well as my AC/DC and Maximum Overdrive saga, which is like a three-parter that was very long, you've heard what it's like when I get excited about telling the story of a making of a film and the reviewing of the film itself. This is not one of those cases, and it's my show, so I don't have to talk about it any more than I want to. But I do want to touch on a few extra little bits and pieces of Dirty Harry lore. There will be more talk of the TV tropes I was reading on the last episode. There'll be even a surprise link from Dirty Harry to Guns N' Roses in the TV tropes listings I found. But to that point, I also feel like it's worth mentioning that, unbeknownst to me, until I did the work on this, there was a series of novels that Dirty Harry was based on, similar to Death Wish, I would assume. I must admit, I am gonna, I could only guess that the Death Wish series was maybe first when it came to, you know, making a successful first movie based on a novel series. I may be wrong. Oh, yes, you may be. You can be, and you are wrong, J. Smith. This is future J. Smith coming back to edit and remove some dumb things I said on the first recording of this part of the episode. I hope you'll forgive me, because I was going a bit stream of consciousness and doing some research on Wikipedia in real time. And it has been a handful of months since I recorded my tangent on the last episode about John Milius and his help in the creation or the formation of Dirty Harry. Obviously, when it comes to a film success, there's a lot of people involved in making the whole thing happen. And John is one of the more, I don't know, public figures that didn't get credit early on for the first film and then got credit later on, according to his documentary, which I was easily swayed by because it's a very, very compelling documentary about a very exciting, charismatic fella, at least for people like me who like writers and hearing their stories. Now, especially ones that don't get along well in Hollywood. Now, the main correction I want to give here is that supposedly the character of Harry Callahan was created by Harry Julian Fink and R.M. Fink. And the novels I'm about to talk about are novelizations that came out 10 years after the first Dirty Harry movie and continued the saga from there. They were not source material. They were capitalizing on the popularity of the Dirty Harry films, and I don't know who made all the money. I'm curious about that when it comes to the folks involved in the creation of the character and the initial treatments, and then the scripts and rewrites and screenplays after the whole experience I went through with the Crow series. Please check those out if you haven't heard them. I'm curious about that. These were actually cranked out not by one author. Dane Hartman was a pen name used by at least three authors between 81 and 83. So there's no real like a rabbit hole for me to go down and research to find out what other things this this author in quotes has done, and see what their process was like. Got me? Now, if you're curious, some of the titles of these books are Duel for Cannons, the first one, Death on the Docks, The Long Death, The Mexico Kill, Family Skeletons, City of Blood, Massacre at Russian River, Hatchet Men, The Killing Connection, Blood of the Strangers, Death in the Air, and The Dealer of Death. I think it's also worth reading a quick synopsis from the Wikipedia entry on Dirty Harry, the character. Inspector Harold Francis Callahan, born October 24, 1928. So if he was alive, he would be almost 100 years old now. Nicknamed Dirty Harry. I mean, Harold Francis Callahan, how much more Irish Catholic can you get there? I don't know what that's a comment about. I'm just saying. There's a stereotypical... well, I guess it's a trope in early American culture that, you know, the Irish became the cops in the early days of the cities, you know, the New England cities and on the East Coast and stuff, not in the South so much, but that they were a class of people that were seen as below a lot of other white ethnicities. So that was just one of those things where, as you see historically with Jewish people being, you know, ousted from many, or for being basically illegal for many years and generations of Jewish people to hold certain kinds of jobs or public offices. Yes, they became jewelers. Yes, they worked with gold. Yes, they worked with silver and diamonds. So that years later, people can, you know, look back and ignore all that and say, how come they're all obsessed with money? Let's make propaganda about it. The Irish, you know, like, I don't know. I'm saying these things because according to the Libsyn statistics on who's downloading the show, a lot of you live in India. It goes like United States, biggest numbers, half those numbers, India. And then it's like Canada and Europe and Australia after that. And those numbers are very small in comparison to India. So there's things about American culture that should, I think, be discussed in this history of rock and roll and film and rock and roll that I do, because most of what I cover is uniquely American, for crying out loud. But I don't think it was an accident, I guess is what I'm saying, that Harold Francis Callahan is the name of this character. It's probably a signal to the reader that, like, hey, this is a throwback character to the old days where the Irish were the cops and they took no shit and they don't have time for your liberal West Coast San Francisco red tape here. So that was mean. I didn't even get past the first sentence of the of the entry. So let's start from the top again. Inspector Harold Francis Callahan, born October 24, 1928, nicknamed Dirty Harry, is a fictional character and protagonist of the Dirty Harry film series, which consists of Dirty Harry, 71, Magnum Force, 73, and I believe Magnum Force was the one where John Milius got full credit for actually writing and hopefully the creation of the character in his film form. Then The Enforcer in 76, Sudden Impact in 83, and then The Deadpool in 88. Callahan is portrayed by Clint Eastwood in each film, which is something we should actually celebrate. They didn't immediately reboot it with someone else. They didn't go for the James Bond formula where they're going to have a new guy every 5 to 10 years. You know, I mean, much less if you're a certain Australian actor. But that's very rare to see, especially in the 80s when it was all about franchises and all about sequels. Good for them. For whatever reason, maybe it's one of those things where Clint Eastwood may have negotiated a deal where he might have had some creative control over that. I don't know. I do know that the main reason the Die Hard movies started to suck so hard after a while is because Bruce Willis obtained the rights to the character and decided he would apparently just be a unstoppable Superman that would jump out of buildings every 5 minutes and crash through windows and get blowed up and not have any negative effects of that. Just get crunched up and set on fire and never have a broken bone or a a problem jumping off of more jets while in mid-flight and punching out bad guys. So it says from his debut, Callahan became the template for a new kind of film cop, an anti-hero who does not hesitate to cross professional boundaries in pursuit of his own vision of justice, especially when the law is poorly served by an inept, incompetent bureaucracy. All dirty tea about to do. Take two. All the Dirty Harry films use take two. Feature Callahan killing criminals, mostly in gunfights. Phrases he uttered in armed standoffs, go ahead, make my day, and you've got to ask yourself one question. Do I feel lucky? Well, do you, punk? Have become iconic, as the 1971 film was criticized for carrying authoritarian undertones. The sequels attempted to be more balanced by pitting Harry against villains from a broader ideological spectrum. Notably in 1973's Magnum Force, in which Harry is shown fighting vigilantism after it goes too far. Hey, you know what? I should probably watch that one. I think that one's got a good reputation. Anyhow, not here to just read a Wikipedia entry. I'm not here to out myself as a person that doesn't do any research except for Wikipedia. I'm not very successful podcaster Mark Maron, who I love, but I think this is another element of the character that's worth talking about nowadays. In the 1980s and 1970s, being right-wing in the era before social media, could it have meant you were racist? Could it have meant you were all about authoritarian power, limiting the freedoms of others? It certainly could. But I think in a more popular, sense, a more routine sort of the average person that watches the news, I think if you wanted people that committed violent crimes to be locked up and taken out of society, and you felt like it was a tragedy that they kept getting out of jail or prison to kill or commit other violent crimes again and again and again, I think that is a position a lot of Americans would have had. And that would kind of, in a lot of ways, make you right wing. I know that Richard Nixon and other politicians like him used phrases like law and order as a bit of a racist dog whistle to signal to supporters that, like, I'm going to crack down on, you know, minorities in their neighborhoods with lots of white cops and make sure they don't get too uppity because we don't like seeing them out in the streets causing a ruckus. And that's why partly why the war on drugs happened from Nixon through Reagan and onward, to basically say this new revolutionary class of young people, whether they be white liberals on campuses in the streets or black people from these ghettos we keep trying to keep them in, out in the streets, causing problems and causing noise, you know, they need to be suppressed. And we can't come out and just say that. We have to say we want, quote unquote, law and order to make a comeback. And we are going to create very stringent penalties for people that are caught in possession of drugs. So stringent that a very small amount that we could just plant on people to double their sentences would be pretty easy for a cop to sort of take care of, to implement, to utilize. And of course, when judges are up for, you know, I mean, judges or sheriffs or anyone that has a public office that is related to the legal profession wants to drum up support, then they want to other certain elements of our society, make you scared of them and say, they're going to be ones that are tough on crime. We've been too soft on crime. We need to be tougher on it because these liberals, they just want criminals to run rampant so they can, you know, cram their penises in your grandma's face while shooting heroin and creating jazz music. What's my point in all this? I just feel like it's valuable to have a little context around a character like Dirty Harry. And this is a time where a lot of people are feeling unsafe. And you know what? If you want to go into it deeper, I'm willing to bet there's about 50,000 YouTube channels talking about vigilantism in pop culture during the era of the 70s and 80s. And, you know, the stories like Bernie Getz, the New York being overrun by crime for a certain chunk of time after white flight and all these people leaving for the suburbs, and what had to happen to sort of slow that trend. I'm going to leave it to those folks, but now get back into Guns N' Roses, while still saying that I think it is unfair to judge products of the 70s in America by a 2020s post-social media lens where young critics can easily benefit from the privilege of having a lot more awareness of racial politics in America, crime politics in America, drug politics in America, and just say, oh, this, you know, if you enjoy this white man in a suit shooting minorities in the streets, it's because you're a Nazi Republican Nixon supporter that just wants to keep people down. I'm not saying this is good. I'm not waving it away. I'm saying the insidious nature of cultural scapegoating is that, like, this is just being presented in most situations as, wouldn't it be great? Wouldn't it be great if bad guys actually got it? They got punished like they did in the cowboy movies that we grew up with. Now that it's this, or the TV shows, it's the 70s and the 80s now. And those of us that were children that had cap guns and grew up in an era where we saw morality plays on television and in the movie theater constantly, where, you know, the sheriff did actually take down the bad guys. It's nice to see this happening in our modern era. It's a fantasy. Yeah, it's a white male power fantasy, if you want to reduce it to that. But it's also a human craving for justice. Just because it's one thing doesn't mean it can't be the other. It's not a binary choice. There, I've alleviated my guilt for not including more Dirty Harry content that, like, hardcore research in this episode, while exacerbating my white guilt. Let's get into a long session with Guns N' Roses in the late 1980s next. There's a fantastic write-up, feature, chapter, I guess I will call it, on Guns N' Roses in a book called The Rock Musician. Now, if you're in a bookstore, or you're browsing a bookseller website, and you see the title of a book called something as generic and plain as The Rock Musician, you keep moving on. In this case, you would probably be wrong to do so, because what this is a collection of some very in-depth interviews from what used to be Musician Magazine. And they put, like, a collection of just the rock stuff that would sell pretty well, presumably, together in this little publication. And, I mean, I won't read you the table of contents. It's worth checking out on Internet Archive if you would like to read it for free. Archive.org. If I remember to, I will put a link to it in the description of this episode. But, I mean, you know, PIL is the chapter right before this one. But this one is Guns N' Roses Are Outlaws and Everyone Has Guns N' Roses by Mark Rowland. And it is from December 1988. I will not be able to just read the whole thing to you. There's a lot. There's a lot. It's in depth. It is big. I will say that Musician Magazine and Keyboard Magazine are the two biggest sources of hard information that is actually interesting and useful to read when it comes to the history of Nine Inch Nails. If that gives you any indication of, you know, of their credibility and their due diligence. So I want to get into just chunks of this because it's such a important time, obviously, in the band's development. And I don't think anything perfectly frames this point in time the way the situation is laid out. Listen to who they're playing with. this is Texas Stadium in Dallas. He says, Mark Rowland, let me make sure I get the name right. Because I just said it and I don't want to forget it. Yeah, Mark Rowland. Rowland. It says, it's a hot afternoon with a tease of rain, like a barbecue pit that occasionally sizzles. 40,000 kids are having a wing ding, sampling an international pop smorgasbord that includes Ziggy Marley, Iggy Pop, and headliners in excess. So Guns N' Roses is big enough to be asked to do this gig, but they are not the headliners. And they're willing to do it as direct support for In Excess. Running second on the bill is Hollywood Garage Band, still being referred to as a garage band, which is a laugh. Guns N' Roses, whose first album, Appetite for Destruction, has unexpectedly sold over 6 million copies, and whose Sweet Child of Mine is currently the nation's top-selling single. So now you know exactly where we're at in Guns N' Roses history, okay? It's their last gig on a 9-month tour, a chance to go out in a blaze of glory. There's just one problem. They don't want to be there. They're tired, they're cranky, they hate In Excess. As usual, they're not shy about venting their feelings. What can they do? Says guitarist Izzy Stradlin. Kick us off the tour? An afterthought of Hurricane Gilbert starts to drizzle over the thousands as Guns N' Roses' Axel, Izzy, lead guitar slash bassist Duff McKagan, and drummer Steve Adler crank into It's So Easy, their paean to the wildlife. It's all they can do to move around without falling on the slippery stage. They can't hear through their monitors, but keep slogging through. Mr. Brownstone, Izzy's little ditty about heroin, in quotes, a ballad called Patience. Guess I could use a little, huh? Says Axel, by way of introduction. A bluesy instrumental rave up from Slash and the band's anthem, Welcome to the Jungle. It's a mess, but it works. Back in the bleachers, the faithful are singing along to every indecipherable word as girls in various articles of Guns N' Roses wear scream just like in old Beatles movies while their guys pump their fists. On stage, the band's still pissed. Guess nobody wants to play today, booms Axel before taking soccer practice with one of the monitors. Next up is Sweet Child, the crowd screaming, Where Do We Go? With gospel fervor. As if Axel knew the answer, then it's Paradise City, and as quickly as they came, the band is out of here. Duff smashing his bass in frustration, Slash cursing because he doesn't have a guitar to smash. They forgot to bring a cheap one, he says. We're less than 40 minutes into a scheduled 75-minute set. Does it get any worse than this? Someone asked backstage, missing the point. At their worst, Guns N' Roses are real, and it connects. Back on the field, the crowd's still cheering. An hour later, the band relaxes in the high roller boxes along the loge, knocking back a few beers and shrugging off the damage, while In Excess clamors below. Axel, however, is still agitated. If Michael Hutchence says anything about me, I'll go back down there and kick his ass. Axel becomes more meditative. I hope we learned a major lesson from this. Don't do something for money, because it ain't gonna work. We agreed to do this show a long time ago, and we've been dreading it ever since. When we finally got out on stage, it just hit us like a ton of bricks. Who the hell are we fooling? Usually, when we get in that situation, we get very punk, says Slash. We blaze, even if we don't play that good, because we're so energetic. But we didn't do that today. We cracked. We didn't take over. The promoters, the bookers, they want us to keep going. We've been getting offers to headline the Forum, Madison Square Garden, but we knew this had to end. And Axel's voice is getting to the point where he can't keep going. Slash flashes a smile. Everybody's been having a good time. The thing is, we're burned out. The narrative then just kind of goes into journalist bullshit. You know, oh, here's the background of Guns N' Roses' rise, and, you know, here's they're from Hollywood. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, reputation, blah, 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 blah. Later on, it says, Slash, Saul Hudson, walks into the neighborhood hamburger hamlet and orders a double stoli with OJ. I've been up since 5 this morning doing phone interviews, he says. Guy called me from Brazil. The album's 14 months old, and it just opened at number 7 in Brazil and Greece. And in Holland, it's like number 10. So I've had to do all of this. Slash is deceptively dissolute. He's not only the band's best musician and a talented artist. He designed Guns N' Roses' logo. He also helped chart the group's course from the start. I'm a real workaholic when it comes to that. Anything else, I'm lazy. I work my ass off to promote the band in the beginning. Get us from spot to spot in the club scene, making flyers and phone calls and screw the right people. I'm pretty level-headed and don't make too many dumb decisions. We negotiated our own record deal. We're very conscientious about what we do and how we do it. When it comes to constructing their music, Slash says his attitude is aggressive. I come up with the majority of the riffs. Axel, the majority of the melodies and lyrics, and Izzy will come up with really good chords. We work together, so everybody enjoys doing it, but I'm adamant. If I hear a riff in my head, I hear the whole band, and then I want to reproduce that. Slash grew up in England. His father designed album covers for Geffen Records. That's weird. But Geffen Records hadn't been around that long at this point, I don't think. I'm not disputing that fact. I'm just saying the way it's positioned, it's like when he was it makes it sound like when he was a little boy, his dad was already working for a record company. You know what I mean? I don't like the way that's placed there. Kind of, I don't know. It's clumsy or it's irresponsible, I think. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. His mother closed for artists like David Bowie and the Pointer Sisters. Surrounded by pop music, he liked everything from Jefferson Airplane to Minnie Riperton. But the Stones, Zeppelin, Beck, Faces, and Aerosmith were major. When I was 14, I was over this girl's house who I'd been trying to pick up for months. And she played Aerosmith Rocks. I listened to it 8 times and forgot all about her. He credits Jimmy Page as his biggest influence. That bluesy sound, and I've always been a real riffs person. Before Izzy, I'd never been able to play with another guitarist. Axel was the only guy on the whole LA scene who could sing. And there was no getting Izzy away from Axel. Funny thing about Izzy is that we each play what we want, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. It can be frustrating for me because he's very stubborn. He plays a very lightweight sort of Keith Richards style, whereas I want a heavy riff. I want us to both play it to make it stick out. There's a lot of songs on the album that I'm not really happy with that way. Welcome to the Jungle, for instance. Sometimes Duff will beef it up like the riff in Paradise City. I'm a little more knowledgeable on guitar. Izzy's a good songwriter with a great sense of style. Guns N' Roses is sort of like, we're the only 5 people in LA that could enjoy what each other did enough to start a band and keep it together. Part of the magic is that we're like this mirror of what kids really go through, what the reality of being a teenager is about. Having to work 9 to 5 and having shitty parents and dealing with cops, authority. So we're very close to the kids we play for. That's what rock and roll is for me. Kind of rebellious thing. Getting away from authority figures, getting laid maybe, getting drunk, doing drugs at some point. We're the kind of band that there's not too many others. There's tons of rock concerts that are about as safe as pie. for a rock show, we're doing something more unpredictable. There's a certain amount of recklessness. We're very fresh with it. Slash grins and orders another vodka double. His fourth. His father, he mentions in passing, was an alcoholic. That sounds sort of childish, he says, but I have to drink a certain amount before we go on stage or I'm awkward and I can't play right. Otherwise, I'm too jittery, but a lot of people see me hanging around clubs drunk off my ass and they think that's what we're all about. We get this image for being irresponsible punks who don't care about anything. Well, we are sort of like that, but we don't do it on purpose. We're just being young. I think the Stones were like that. Well, oh, sorry. Then the writer says, well, one of the Stones died, and you have a reputation for careening pretty close to the edge yourself. Our drug situation is not as bad as it was, says Slash, a little more reservedly. Yeah, I've been out a few times, blue and all that. Jesus. We've sang Knocking on Heaven's Door. That's dedicated to my best friend Todd, who died in a hotel room a while back. We'd copped some stuff and got it right there. I tried to bring him back, and he was like my best friend. That really scared me. I had a habit, and I finally stopped it. And every so often, I'll chip, you know, just for the fun of it. But that's not something you talk about because you don't want people to think he's a drug addict. I'm not promiscuous like I used to be either, because I worry about AIDS. And also, you burn out on it. It's not that big a thing. And so now, what do? He smiles engagingly. We're at the MTV Awards, and I meet Tracy Lords, and we went out the other night. He shakes his head in disbelief. I'm a parody of my own lifestyle, I tell you. And there's more to this last section, but you kind of you get the gist of it, right? Let's hop ahead a little bit. It says, let's see. The first thing I remember about Axel, Izzy is saying, this is before I knew him, is the first day of class, eighth or ninth grade. I'm sitting in class and I hear this noise going on in front and I see these fucking books flying past and I hear this yelling and there's this scuffle and then I see him, Axel, and this teacher bouncing off a door jamb and then he's gone down the hall with a whole bunch of teachers running after him. That's the first thing, Izzy laughs. I'll never forget it. Stradlin has the gaunt classic look of a guy who was born to play guitar. When he's in the mood, he radiates a kind of shy charm, and he punctuates his stories with droll, cynical humor. When I was 11 or 12, I had this friend whose older brothers were like hooligans. They rode bikes, would get drunk, and fight all the time. And they'd have these bands play at this big farmhouse. It was like an airplane hangar, so I'd be hanging out there, getting shit-faced. And after a while, they'd be so drunk they couldn't even play. Go, come on up here, little kid, and play the drums. So that was the first adrenaline rush. Other than that, my life was completely boring. Izzy grew up in Indiana. So far out and bumfuck, I could drive to somebody's house for 10 miles on all dirt roads. His parents split up when he was a teenager. He moved with his mother to the larger burg of Lafayette, where he and Axel eventually met and formed their first garage band. They were into punk, and Lafayette's bars only had room for country and cover bands. We hated at the time. When you're 16 and you live out there, you hate everything you see. After trying to his luck in Chicago and Indianapolis, Izzy threw his drums into the back of a Chevy Impala and headed for L.A. Within 3 days, he was in a band. Since I had a car and a drum kit, I was an asset, whose next gig was a downtown warehouse. We're getting ready to go on, Stradlin recalls, and these guys show up completely in drag. I mean, lipstick, eyeliner, pink spandex, afros. This was my band. They didn't tell me there was a motif, you know? And it was like slam music. 1, 2, 3, 4. We made it about 3 songs, and then all these skinheads were on stage spitting and beating the fuck out of the band. I took a cymbal stand, took a few swings, and then I was out the back door. That kind of broke me into the way things were out here. After that, I had no problems with how anyone looked or sounded, or if they didn't like you. So I guess it was a good way to break the ice. That was 1979. The next year, Easter morning, Axel shows up at my front door, soaking wet with a backpack. He'd been looking for me for about a month. He didn't know how big this place was. A couple of years later, Izzy's playing guitar, and they were living in Hollywood. Slumming it here and there, we started writing songs in this roach-infested pad off Franklin Avenue. We were doing speed like there's no tomorrow. And night after night, we would just pump out this fast, upbeat, insane music. slap together a band, and I'd tell club owners we were playing parties and we could easily bring in 500 people. When 20 would show up, they'd get really upset, and we'd never get paid. But we were slowly getting it together. The band Hollywood Rose eventually broke up. When Axel and Izzy reunited, they decided, let's not waste any more time. We moved up in life to West Hollywood, Izzy jokes, and met Slash and Steve and Duff. It's funny, before I'd even met Slash, I'd seen this drawing he made of Aerosmith in a music store, and I thought, I gotta meet this guy. Once we got that lineup together, everything we did revolved around the music, I think, because we were all so fed up. That was all we were about. It's still that way. So if we disappear tomorrow, at least the music's there. Stradlin is the closest thing in the band to a loner. When he's on tour, he likes to wander the streets by himself, and his girlfriend mentions he'd like to buy a house in the desert. But with success, he says, I enjoy life more now. I'm not so pissed all the time. When you got no bread, drug problems, no money, and winos in your alley throwing up, it does tend to aggravate you. It's much better now. I can live like a normal person. I mean, for 10 years, I lived here. I never had a bed. I just bought one, and it's a futon. I guess I'm used to lying on the floor. One night during the recent tour, Izzy saw his father for the first time in 8 years. He comes walking backstage unannounced, completely out of the blue. It took a second or two to recognize him. It was a real trip. But it was definitely not, he catches the thought, brings it back home. Well, I don't want to get into it. I mean, in 10 years, I've only been back to Indiana twice. I don't even know anyone there anymore. I don't keep in touch like Axel does. But when I look back, I do see some kind of stability that comes from growing up in a fucking cornfield. You're at one with the earth, Izzy laughs. You don't give a shit about much. It's a simple life. How does that explain Axel? Well, that has a lot to do with how he was brought up and how he sees things. He's very uncompromised. He was the first one to say, fuck this. As if to prove his point, Axel never shows up for the photo shoot. After 3 hours, Izzy decides he'd better hit the road. I know this guy, he says. If I don't leave now and he does show up, we'll have to wait 5 hours next time. There's a little talk with Vicky Hamilton. There's talk about Geffen Records. There's talk about the deal. And then, let's see. Talking about Appetite for Destruction being put together as a very heavy drug period for the band, Izzy says frankly. A lot of the music is a reflection of that. There's always a lot of abuse going on in Hollywood. But at that time, it was like we were in the middle of a pinwheel. As rock and roll stories go, this part's not unique, but what makes Appetite for Destruction special isn't simply the band's penchant for extreme experience, but its ability to reflect it in the songs without wallowing in romanticism or cheap sentiment. I think that's a very, very well-stated point. I think that is what a lot of bands and a lot of journalists never understood about Guns N' Roses. And that's what they don't understand about a lot of good songwriters, especially in punk and rock and roll. It's not that Guns N' Roses are geniuses or anything, but they wrote stuff, you know, from the point of view of someone that was in it. And everyone else seems like they write from this level above of observation, or so deep in it they can't convey. They can't convey the events taking place around them without being unrelatable, you know. Wanting you to feel sorry for them for something that you've had no part in doing. The article says, the power of a song like Mr. Brownstone, which Izzy admits he wrote in about 5 minutes while I was cooking something up. Har, har, har. Har, hars are mine, not the interviewers, is in the way it evokes not only the thrill of the fast lane, the Bo Diddley-ish rhythm, but also through Axel's frantic cadences, its implicit terror. No matter how far flung the band's other themes, the Come Hither Decadence and Welcome to the Jungle, the prayer for deliverance in Paradise City, the paranoia of Out to Get Me, or the wary hopes expressed in Sweet Child of Mine, the point of view is invariably existential. The songs supply no answers, but ask plenty of questions. Well put, I say. Let's see. Talking a little bit to Duff later on in this piece, Duff says, none of us are the greatest musicians, you know. We all have big technical holes, but What puts us apart from other bands is that it's always rough and real. We'll never be like Rush. We'll never be that good. But I think we're way more honest. In some ways, it's a calling of rebel spirit to kids because we always do what we want. We hate to admit it, Slash admits, but they are sort of like teenage heroes, speaking about Aerosmith. And in concert together, Aerosmith are more polished by far, but GNR thrashed out the drama of its members' lives, and Axl's Janis Joplin-like stage presence connected on a deeper emotional level. By tour's end, they were opening... they were openers in name only, drawing half the crowds and running away with the t-shirt concessions. Record sales, no contest. As the group's popularity ballooned, so did its bad boy reputation, to the point where some members began to feel like cartoon characters. It worries me, Izzy says. When these kids would come up and try to give me Coke and stuff, I go, oh, no thanks, not this part of the tour. Because the first 2 months you go for it, and the next thing you know, they're dragging you on stage from the bus. You know, I really liked it when the kids loved us and we were still sort of underground, said Slash. Now it's gotten to the point where we're sort of a circus act for normal society to go, look at them fall down. Isn't that cute? Sometimes it just pisses me off. I always thought of us basically as nice guys who were over-exaggerated about. I mean, we don't rob banks. We don't beat up girls. We don't smash guitars over kids' heads in the front rows. I don't see why it's such a crime to be us. The fact is, we're really sensitive people, and that's probably why, for one, I drink so much, why Axel flies off the handle and has these huge fits of total depression. Because we're still living life, and sometimes that's hard to deal with. There's no big macho sense in this band. Duff's married. Axel's got a girlfriend he loves very much. Maybe sometimes we have relationships or other things that just drive us crazy, but no one wants to know about that, though, because at this point, it's not Guns N' Roses for any of that to happen. So the next bit moves into a little bit of Axel time. As we know, this is the end of 88, so we're talking about just before Lies comes out the following year, and that's gonna be mentioned here in a second. Days go by. No Axel. Notes are dropped at the hotel where he's living with girlfriend Erin Everly, the inspiration for Sweet Child. He's spotted around town, hanging out with Slash at a party, cutting background vocals for Don Henley, helping to put the final mixes on the acoustic tracks for the Guns N' Roses for Guns N' Roses' forthcoming EP. He dodges a second photo shoot, ducks an interview appointment. Nothing personal is explained. It's just Axel's way. Vicky Hamilton recalls that on the day Guns N' Roses were slated to begin their tour with Aerosmith, no one knew where Axel was or if he'd even make it to the gig. People were sitting in the Hard Rock Cafe taking bets on it. He finally appeared an hour before showtime. Much later, toward the end of the tour, Axel approached Guns N' Roses' gregarious road manager, Doug Goldstein, concerned. Goldstein says that the others felt he'd become a prima donna. I haven't changed, have I, Doug? Of course not, Goldstein replied affectionately. You've always been a prick. That's pretty much the attitude regarding Axel, frustration mitigated by sympathy and respect. Blah, 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 blah. Talking about Axel, no one tells him what to do. He finally appears. He has some time on his hands before popping over to a party for George Michael, of all people. I've read reviews where people who like us say we're not the kind of band that'll be caught spinning faith. And I used to have that attitude before I started listening to the record over and over. Now all I know is that listening to his record, it'll teach you how to deal with women. The subject of women brings to mind the first Appetite for Destruction album cover, pulled by Geffen and now, of course, a collector's item, after protests that its imagery condoned sexual violence towards women. We didn't put that out to outrage people, Axel protests. I thought it was a very cool piece of art that would stand the test of time. I don't think it was encouraging sexual abuse at all. I think it's an idea in people's heads that she is attractive, a sexual fantasy, like this poor girl got abused and you're thinking about how your husband wants to fuck her. So you're upset. People get scared of their own thoughts. What thoughts scare you? The people are always trying to provoke some kind of a fight so they can sue me. I'm scared of thrashing an asshole and going to jail for it. For some reason, I can walk into a room and someone will pick a fight. That's always happening with me. Like, I went to a store once to buy a stun gun. We were headlining the whiskey and things were getting out of hand, so I figured I'll buy stun guns. We won't have to break their jaw. We'll just zap them and carry them out. So my brother and I walked into the store and I say, excuse me, sir, can I see this stun gun, please? Being polite. And the guy goes, listen, son, I don't need your bullshit. My brother says, listen, he just got signed. He can buy 10 of these. And the guy says, I don't care. I'll sell them to you, but not to him. That happens a lot to me. If I'm breaking the law, fine. But when I'm just being a nice guy, all right, I think that something's missing in that story. I just walked in. I mean, is it like does his brother look like a straight-laced, clean-cut guy and Axel's got long hair and the guy at the gun store is like, fuck you, hippie? They get that. Like, I mean, it's not nice. It's not justifiable, but he's like, I don't want to make money selling things to you that I sell to everyone else, Axl Rose. It's like every single drunk maniac that gets thrown out of a comedy club and then the next day goes on social media and says they were kicked out for no good reason. They were just sitting there in the front row having a good time with everybody else. And the comedian singled them out, had security toss them in the street. Because, you know, that's what comedians want to do. They want to get rid of audience members that are doing nothing and having a great time and cause problems for the club. I don't think I don't think it makes a lot of sense that like Axel walks in. It's like he's just, I don't know, like he's a Ward Cleaver and he's like, hello, sir. I would like to purchase some of your wares. And the guy behind the counter is like, fuck you, dipshit. I'm going to sell whatever I want to your older brother, but not to you. All right. Let's see. They talk about him back in Indiana. He was thrown in jail at least 20 times, although he never did anything worse than get drunk and rowdy. He says, I was one of the craziest of my friends, but also one of the smartest. So they figured I was the ringleader. They never got me for anything though. Once this girl picked me up in a car, she was 16 or 17 and her mom reported it stolen. The police tried to get me for grand theft auto, contributing to the delinquency of a minor, statutory rape. And I didn't touch the girl. After they filed the charges, I went over to her house and we had a party. Then I left town. They talk about his childhood. He says, I was in the country. You get up and sing old gospel songs. And they're talking about him being a singer in church. And hymns and gospel hits of the 70s. I love to work on harmonies. I was always getting in trouble in choir practice for singing everybody else's parts. Axel won Bible contests, taught Sunday school, played the piano. He saw amazing religious occurrences, miracles. But became disappointed when nothing happened to him. Secular music became the true revelation. He acquired eclectic pop tastes. To develop his singing, he locked himself in the bathroom every day and sang along with Nazareth albums and the Eagles' greatest hits. Now he listens to Ennio Morricone and old Sinatra records. Writing songs, I try not to follow any rules. Slash will sit with his guitar and I'll run through ideas as he plays. We connect the pieces together. We push each other. Izzy and I write real quick off the top of our heads. We write a lot of fun stuff. Lyrics, though, require solitude. I want to write about some of the situations I've seen, types of people I've met in the last 2 years, and I don't want anyone to influence that. People look over your shoulder and say, I don't know if you should say that, man. That's a little heavy, but I don't want to be censored before I bring the song to the band. There are songs. Here we go. On an upcoming EP, he says, that will probably freak people out. Axel's decided to deal with it by writing a note of explanation slash apology on the album cover. He also mentions that he recently bought a custom Corvette. It's got a Chevy engine, a four cam that goes 180 plus miles an hour. I'll join a racetrack where they'll teach you how to drive it fast. I like the idea of having a car where I won't be so eager to put my gun in the car and shoot somebody. Oh? And how are you dealing with success? Right now, it's hard. It's going to take a little time from living like a rat in the streets to being able to manage my accounts, find places to live, buy houses. I'm getting a place here and in the Midwest, and eventually I'd like to live in New York and get ideas for songs in the street. But right now, I'm just trying to move real fast, get this crap out of the way, and get myself stable. Because we have another record to make, and I really want to make that record. It's like a dream. We get to be the big, talented artists, respected by people in the business. I hope to do as much as possible. Maybe a double album. So if anything happens to the band, it'll still live on for a while. Right now, I think it's too early for people on the outside to really tell what we're all about. So already, it's the end of 88, and he knows he's going to put out lyrics, I would assume, on One in a Million that are going to piss people off. Freak people out, he says, but, you know. And he knows he wants to make a double album after that. Interesting. I hope I'll be really satisfied after that. I don't want to go solo. But there are areas I'd like to explore. Maybe movies. I might not be able to say to stay in the band to do it. So I'm not going to say we'll be around forever, but I hope I'll write the kind of music that sticks around for a long time. Whether you hear it on the radio or not, that's what I want. To be part of a band that gets a little place in history. The way he says it gives the thought weight. Axel is the kind of guy who seems almost uncomfortably alert to changes in the weather, to the sensitivity of a lyric, the nuance of a song, a sudden shift of mood. Only because I react to everything, he says quietly. I react to thoughts. I can be sitting here in a good mood and think about something really fucked, and I can't get it out of my head. I'll react to it. If I hold back, I can walk around frustrated for a very long period of time. When I talk with an interviewer, it hurts my feelings if they act like my best friend, then chop me down. I always try to let people know what they want when we're talking. I read that twice. I just had to be sure. I always try to let people know what they want when we're talking. All right. I think I'm growing. I have more insights into things. I know when I listen to music, I really want something to be there. Like, I hated Metallica, but then everyone started talking about them, so I bought their records. And the song that really caught me was Fade to Black. I got addicted to that song. It was the only thing I could put on at the end of the day, which is usually around dawn. It's a song about suicide, but I would put it on before I went to sleep, and it would make me relax. For some reason, it made me want to try harder. I think, yeah, I can get up and face tomorrow. The only thing that worries me about death is I have this record to make, and I'll be really pissed off if I die before I make it. After that, I won't give a shit. That's when it's going to get dangerous. You know, this article made me think about something that I don't think I've ever really... I've never really considered too much, and I'm glad that I read it now. It's really easy for people to say, oh, Guns N' Roses were just badass, and they were just tougher than all the other Hollywood bands and stuff, right? You know, like they could just see that, okay, there was, you know, there was 80s new wave, and there was 80s heavy metal and hair metal, and then before... you know, thrash metal and alternative rock went mainstream, there was Guns N' Roses to sort of fill this gap and kill off some of the really pretty stuff. And I don't think that explanation goes far enough. And I think the example of Out to Get Me is a very important one. You listen to that song and listen to Axl's lyrics and his delivery and think about what the interviewer was saying about the sort of point of view that the Guns N' Roses songs inhabit, right? Think about Axl's delivery of those lines about, you know, people pushing you into a corner just to get you to fight, to provoke you. You know, cops, teachers, authority figures, parents, whatever. The kids can relate to that in some way. Bullies, you know, at their school. Kids their own age, treating them like shit and treating them like caged animals. Like, I think a lot of us felt that way at the age of 11, if not the age of 13, 14, 15. I felt like I was under attack all the time whenever I went to school. And I wasn't, but I felt like I was. It only takes a couple of people in your daily life, especially in an institutionalized social scenario like school, to make you feel like you've got a target on your back wherever you go. And you know, Axl is a guy that demonstrably has that going on in his life. And he conveys the frustration and the fury and the rebellious anger of it very, very well. Out to Get Me makes you feel like, you know, this person understands what it's like to be abused and pushed around. And the only triumph in it is, you know, I'm already gone. The only triumph in it is they won't judge me. You know, they won't basically they won't destroy me because I'm too pissed off. It's not even like I'm too good of a person. It's like I'm too fucking pissed off. I got something I've been building up inside for so, and when he says for so fucking long, that is so powerful in how much defiance is in the delivery. And this is the key to me, to Guns N' Roses' appeal really at its heart, is that you're not going to get that kind of delivery from Great White. And there's a lot more furious rebellion in hardcore punk at this time, but it's so standardized. There's no swing, there's no swagger to it, there's no dynamic to it compared to what Guns N' Roses is doing. I mean, if you're ensconced in hardcore punk, of course you see all the dynamics that other people don't. You know, it's like death metal. It's like there's, if you're into it, you see all the details that outsiders don't really get. To outsiders, it sounds like a whole bunch of noise and that's all it's ever going to be. But like the anger and the venom in hardcore punk was like regimented. It's just constant. It's just, it's like a fever pitch of just being pissed off. Nonstop. And if you're into it, there's more layers in there for you. But if you're not, if you're a fan of rock and roll primarily, and especially if you're a teenager in 1987, you hear Guns N' Roses and you hear something vicious that you've never heard before from anybody else. But it's a personal viciousness. It's a wounded sort of reaction to people fucking with you. And the lyrics, you know, I lose my head, I close my eyes. Those are the words of someone who is retreating and or in the interest of self-preservation, not fighting back and just holding themselves back so they can escape the situation, hopefully without, you know, being, I don't know, beaten or locked up or whatever it is, so they can go on living their life. That's conveyed very, very well and very, very honestly without spelling out the details of the scenario that someone else might not be able to relate to. So yeah, this whole exercise in the history of Guns N' Roses and how they were treated and how they were portrayed back in the day has given me a lot more sympathy for Axl. Whereas I would usually just side with everybody else in the band over him in the past. I see now that that's not really warranted or fair. But we're going to make fun of him later before the show's over for sure. So a little spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down. And yeah, if you're familiar with me in the show, I usually correct myself when I say we, and I go, what the fuck am I saying? We, it's just me making the show by my fucking self. It's a we this time. There's going to be a group thing to close out the Guns N' Roses saga with the Deadpool. So get ready for that. But we still got a ways to go, and I'm still going to give Axl a lot more time and a lot more exploration of his character before we get to that point. More time for It's So Easy and Other Lies, because I can't get enough of that wonderful Duff. And this section of the book talks about the lineup getting together. So he talks about, you know, this is a time not long after getting laid off from Black Angus. He gets another job in an office in a back alley near where Hollywood Boulevard crosses the freeway. The company ostensibly sold office supplies, but the specifics of my work made me wonder. A day's work typically consisted of a pistol-packing guy in a tracksuit with a difficult-to-pinpoint East European accent telling me how to drive an unmarked truck or panel van between two random anonymous addresses in the city. Scratch that. To call the hidden alleyways, abandoned lots, and remote underpasses where I found and left trucks' addresses would be a stretch. I never asked what was being transported, and it didn't seem like a safe question, I guess. With all that driving around town, I began to see how segregated L.A. was. A lot of my colleagues would refuse to make deliveries to Watts, That blew me away. In Seattle, there just weren't places people refused to go. Seattle had a black area, the Central District, but things weren't delineated nearly as starkly as they were in L.A. I went to school in the Central District. In L.A., people who lived in Hollywood didn't leave Hollywood. People in the Jewish enclave of Fairfax didn't leave Fairfax. People in Watts didn't leave Watts and didn't even seem to know where Hollywood was. Fear swathed the city. Just listening to Fear yesterday. Watching their performance of I Love Living in the City from Fall of Western Civilization. So, sorry. Digression. One day in February 85, I was coming home from work. I ran into Izzy. He told me he was starting a new band with a couple of guys from L.A. Guns. The band Slash had taken me to see back in October. Axl Rose, the vocalist from the version of L.A. Guns I had seen, had grown up with Izzy in Indiana and had followed him out to L.A. Axl had moved into a place on our low-rent, high-crime block of Orchid Street, this buzzing hive of prostitution and drug dealing. Izzy's new band also featured Tracy Guns on lead guitar. They were calling the new group Guns N' Roses. Almost immediately, the new group parted ways with their first bass player. Izzy came to me at that point. "Don't you play bass?" he asked me. "I own a bass," I said. I was getting comfortable playing four strings by then, but I had not come close to developing my own style yet. Fortunately, one of the adventures of being young, I had just turned 21, was fearlessness and unbridled confidence, not to mention the fact that I no longer had a guitar. At this point, it was bass or nothing. When I showed up for my first GNR rehearsal in late March 1985, Axel and I said hi to each other and started joking around about this and that. I liked him right away. Whoever was running the sound then asked Axel to test out the microphone. Axel let out one of his screams, and it was like nothing I'd ever heard. There were two voices coming out at once. There's a name for that in musicology, but all I knew in that instant was this dude was different and powerful and fucking serious. He hadn't yet entirely harnessed his voice. He was more unique than great at that point. But it was clear that he hadn't moved out to Hollywood from Indiana for the weather. He was here to stake a claim and show the fucking world what he had. As for Izzy, he wasn't a great guitar player, but I liked that. Both in him and in general, I wasn't a great guitar player either. It was a punk thing. One night when we were talking after a rehearsal, Izzy mentioned a band called Naughty Women. It rang a bell. "I know that band," I said, trying to place the name. "I think I played a gig on the same bill with them once. Wait, were they crossdressers?" "Yep," Izzy said. He paused. "I was the drummer," he said. "Cool," I thought. This guy really was a veteran of the punk rock club scene. He was the real deal. And according to the Musician Magazine interview, that would have been 1979. So like 6 years before this, I mean, maybe. You know, unless he played for another band that had crossdressers in it, and or unless the Musician Magazine guy got the date wrong. Izzy and Axel already had some songs. Blah, blah, blah. Think About You, Anything Goes, Move to the City, Shadow of Your Love, and Don't Cry. And they covered Jumpin' Jack Flash and Heartbreak Hotel. The drummer was a guy named Rob Gardner. And Tracy was an incredible guitar player. But his sound was also really metal. My initial impression was that he didn't have the feel I recognized in Slash. Once again, I realized with a sinking feeling that this was not the band I was seeking, not one that could move the needle musically. But they had some shows booked, and he liked Izzy and Axel, so he decides to stick it out for a while. We played Dancing Waters Club, another gig so forgettable I can't remember the name of the venue. Any excitement I had about the band dwindled. I missed the next rehearsal. Axel called me after that. He could tell I was pulling back and asked me to please come to the next rehearsal. I reluctantly agreed. Axel met me outside the rehearsal space to talk about my reservations. "You have to be part of this," he said. "Give it another chance." And one thing I soon learned about Axel, if he saw something in a person, he would do everything possible to ensure that person remained part of his vision. Part of my problem with the band was that I was skeptical about the commitment of Tracy and Rob. Both had comfortable suburban lives in L.A., I had already recognized the difference between people from L.A. and people who had moved there. Axel and Izzy were distinct, even from other transplants. They were serious in a whole different way. Axel sometimes slept on the street back then. It was also clear that Izzy would do whatever it took, heroin habit or not. "You can come with us or not," they seemed to say, "but we're going to make our way and realize our dream." I liked that. Still, I wasn't sure how to best express this to Axel. And that's a thing that I think not a lot of men are honest enough to do after the fact. When they write their stories or they tell their stories, I think a lot of men are just like, they want credit in the moment for what was only actually established in hindsight. They want credit for being that in like sort of aware of what was going on, you know, in detail, when really it's the kind of thing they can only understand like looking back. And very honest of him to say, here's the effect of what I was feeling and thinking, but I couldn't convey it yet. I like that he makes that distinction. He doesn't think that Rob and Tracy are cut out for going all in and sacrificing to work on everything to work on their craft. Axel didn't argue. So there you go. Axel wouldn't say he agreed either, but he wouldn't argue, which means he agrees. I'm sure. Later on, he says, I pulled Axel aside as well as Izzy. Listen, how would you guys like to play some places beside fucking Dancing Waters in San Pedro? They nodded. If we're going to play for three people, I said, let's at least go do it other places. Fucking A, said Izzy. I could tell immediately that Izzy understood what I was up to. He had been through this before. He knew this was a way to test the links in a band and find the weak ones. In the first wave punk bands I played in, we booked our own gigs, functioned as our own managers, handled our own dough, made our own concert t-shirts. The do-it-yourself ethic had been strong, and as a result, I knew the nuts and bolts of the business. With some songs mastered and these local gigs under our belts, I knew I could use the contacts I'd accumulated over the years to line up some shows for the fledgling Guns N' Roses, a punk rock tour of the West Coast. I think I can book us a tour, I said. It'll be bare bones, but we'll be out there playing. They loved the idea. Yeah, let's do it. I was excited now, too. We would know by the end of this whether Guns N' Roses was the real deal or not. Punk rock tours in those days ran on pure adventure and adrenaline. You counted yourself lucky if you earned enough to pay for gas and still had something left over to buy ramen noodles. You slept at a crash house if you could find one, or on the club floor if the owner liked you. But none of that was important. The main thing was it offered the chance to prove yourself, push yourself beyond the confines of your comfort zone, and make music you believed in to other people's take music you believed in to other people's towns, to throw all caution to the wind. Come to think of it, there was no caution in those days. Obviously, if you know the story of GNR, you know this is it, the big first step. Going up the West Coast, car breaks down, you know, they play with some friends of his up in Seattle. If you listen to the Soundgarden, Chris Cornell episodes I've done, you know, more of that story. And let's see, Rob and Tracy are skeptical about the whole thing from the start. He says, I guess they weren't sure whether to take the leap of faith necessary to leave home with nothing but your bandmates and wits to depend on. And just a few weeks before we were to leave, they broke the news. They weren't up for a no-budget road trip. Not knowing where we would sleep each night was too much for them. I assured them we'd find places to crash. And anyway, what did it matter? We'd be on a tour, a concept to me that was pure magic. Didn't matter. First Rob, then Tracy backed out. We had 10 days before we were scheduled to leave for the tour. Don't worry, I told Izzy and Axel, who were fully committed and for whom hitting the road had the same mythic appeal it had for me. I know a couple of guys we can bring in. And I think we all know who those guys are. Bop-a-dop, bop-a-dop-ow. I will leave it to you, dear listener, to decide how many different Guns N' Roses books you would like to read about what happens next between Slash's book, Steven's book, Duff's book, the Stephen Davis book, and various Mick Wall books and others. More from the TV tropes list on Dirty Harry Deadpool. Let's see, we left off at Distracted by the Sexy. We're moving on to Don't Explain the Joke. The female reporter notes how Harry is having his 15 minutes, then has to explain to Harry how Andy Warhol said everyone would be famous for 15 minutes. A well-known comment Harry is clearly old enough to have heard before. Double standard. A female journalist blackmails Harry into going to dinner with her Imagine what would happen if a male journalist did that to a female cop. Dub name change. Harry was renamed Harry Callaghan or Callaghan with a G instead of with a GH instead of just an H. The Italian release because the local distributor thought it sounded better. Evil Brit. Yes. Yes. Rook speaks with a British accent. He more likely counts in as an in-universe fake Brit as he's taken on Peter Swan's persona due to his psychological condition. Exorcist Head appears in the film that Peter Swan is directing with the effect causing a malfunctions. Johnny Squares fed up accuses Swan of ripping off the Exorcist. Swan, this is not a ripoff. It's an homage, you stupid. Fame through infamy. One of the random threats that Harry has to deal with is a man who calls saying he wants to confess the Deadpool murders. And he's going to set himself on fire. And when he's getting interviewed by Samantha, the man admits that he just made that call to have reporters come to the scene because he wanted to commit suicide by setting himself on fire and become remembered for it. Samantha manages to discourage him by turning off the camera and saying nobody will air his death. Genre savvy. Aware of the fate of Harry's previous partners, Quan wears a bulletproof vest. He survives with only a few broken ribs after the remote car bomb goes off. The only other partner of Harry's to survive was Chico from the first movie, also thanks to his vest. Good luck charm. Quan's tattoos, which his grandfather insisted he get after hearing he was Harry's partner. Harry tells him a bulletproof vest would be more practical. Fortunately, Quan's grandfather also told him, when your partner gives you advice, take it. Grand finale, the end of the line for Dirty Harry. Eastwood retired the character after this movie, stating that his age would make him a parody. Good for you, Clint. Thank you for not going back. Large ham, Johnny Squares. It's a given when you're played by Jim Carrey. Loony fan. Harlan Rook is an obsessed fan of Peter Swan. Out of touch from reality, he accuses Swan of stealing ideas from him and tries to frame him with the Deadpool murders. Another indicator that there's really only one source of the Charisse getting, you know, molested by and kicked in the stomach by Izzy story is that in both the Guns N' Roses FAQ book and Mick Wall's War, the unauthorized biography of William Axl Rose, they both take their story straight from Motley Crue's The Dirt narrative. All right. They both go straight into that. They quote it directly, and they say that that's where the story comes from. So they don't have anything else to fill that out with, except a little tiny bit in the Mick Wall book where, let's see, they were presented with the gong for Best Heavy Metal Hard Rock Video for Sweet Child of Mine. Axl's new friend Tom Petty was also booked onto the show, and Axl and Izzy joined him on stage for Free Fallen, followed by a ferocious run through Elvis's Heartbreak Hotel. Unfortunately for Izzy, Motley Crue singer Vince Neil was also in attendance backstage and used the occasion to pay Izzy back for what he saw as a slight against his wife. That's all he says about the alleged physical attack in public by Izzy. A supposed slight against his wife, right? What he saw as a slight. Catching him by surprise as the guitarist walked off stage, Vince punched him in the face. Izzy toppled over, his lip badly gashed, but otherwise completely unabashed by the whole thing. Newly sober. I wasn't in the mood for fucking around with Vince. Axl, however, had other ideas and chased after the Crue singer to exact his own revenge. And then it cuts into the quotes from The Dirt from Vince. So let's go to Vince again. That's right. From Vince Neil's Tattoos and Tequila to Hell and Back with one of rock's most notorious frontmen by Vince Neil and Mike Sager. Because, you know, if you heard the previous Guns N' Roses episodes I did, I'm tireless when it comes to covering the MTV fights in as many different ways as I can. So let's see. He says in his own book, we were stoked to get the exposure because they were presenting an award supposedly for best heavy metal album at the MTV Music Video Awards. Okay. Doesn't say who won. After we did our bit, we were sitting in the audience. Now, remember in the dirt, he says he was like, they were out in the parking lot and the guys were going to their limos and he went back inside through a backstage. So supposedly implying he went back through like some side door backstage exit or something. After we did our bit, we're sitting in the audience when Guns N' Roses came out to play with Tom Petty. Earlier in the year, while I was away on a whitewater rafting trip with some guys, GNR rhythm guitarist Izzy Stradlin had tried to pick up Charisse, who was partying with some friends at the Cat House. Oh, sorry, Cat House, not the Tropicana. So if I said Tropicana earlier on in another take, so I apologize. When she told him she was married to me, it didn't faze him one bit. He was all over her. Finally, she pushed him away. Izzy was really drunk, I guess. He starts this fight with Charisse. Maybe not the best move. He pulled down her top in front of everyone. When she slapped his face, he fucking kicked her in the stomach. What kind of an animal does that? One thing a lot of people don't know about me is that for years I studied Tang Soo Do, a Korean martial art. I have a red belt, which isn't a black, I know, but I can still kick some ass if I want. I have the arrest record to prove it. Yeah, that's another reason why guys that are prone to anger and getting in fights shouldn't take martial arts, maybe. It just makes you want to be ready for it, fight all the time, and it's generally not going to happen unless you make the decision. Generally, for most people, don't come at me with your story of how like five guys jumped you and you wish you had known martial arts. You probably would have still lost or whatever. As GNR was playing, I made my way back to the wings when Izzy came off stage. I was like, hey, you fuck with my wife or something like that. I don't remember the exact words I said, but I had said something. And he's like, fuck you. And I'm like, yeah, really? And I fucking hit him with a solid right and he went down. He was out cold. Out cold, as opposed to a busted lip and being confused and not pursuing the fight. Suddenly, there was security everywhere. These award shows are lousy with moonlighting cops and other paid thugs. It was a fucking madhouse. Finally, they take me into custody or whatever. There's a guard on either side holding an arm. That's when big, tough Axl Rose comes up. He's so brave with the cops holding me back. He's like, I'm going to fucking kill you. How could you hit my guitar player? All right, so let's pause there for a second. So the story has changed totally from the version he told in the dirt. In this case, there's a crowd of off-duty cops holding him by the arms, and they just hold him there while Axl gets to saunter up and act like a tough guy, as opposed to them pulling him away, him pulling his arms out from their grip, meaning they let him go, and then him walking towards the door, and then Axl yelling at something behind his back and making him turn around. So in this case, he says, what a fucking puss. I'm like, I'll fucking go right fucking now, bitch. And then security dragged me away. As you might remember, this started a whole feud. I don't even know how Axl got into it. It had nothing to do with Axl. It was just between me and Izzy. As far as I was concerned, the Izzy shit was over. So the confusion and the incredulousness with which Axl reacts to him shouldn't be a surprise, because no one else seems to know what this is all about. And, you know, Izzy just gets sucker punched in front of his bandmate and he doesn't understand why his bandmate has a problem with it. There's also this whole thing that's hard to take seriously. He and the other guys in Motley Crue love talking about how if one person attacked, you know, like someone in their band, all the other guys would jump him. You know, or if anyone started trouble with one of the guys in their band, all the guys would jump them, you know, like they were Hell's Angels and stuff. So it's not surprising that somebody would react, you know, a bit violently to you violently attacking their rhythm guitarist. That's the fact that he quotes Axl the way he does, like, how could you hit my fucking guitar player in the other account? Kind of an indicator that no one knows that this is justified, right? So maybe if you did a little better job explaining yourself, this wouldn't happen. also, you know, you could have it out with Izzy in a different capacity, in a different way. You could still whoop his ass, but he, Vince maintains that, well, no, I just punched him out and that was it. And now it's over between me and Izzy. I don't care anymore. I'm not pissed off. I'm only pissed at Axel because Axel wanted to keep the fight going. But I feel like if you were really that tough, you could go a couple, you know, a couple swings, a couple kicks with Izzy in a more controlled environment. But in an MTV award show, you know, it's like that little bit in Dazed and Confused, you know, where the dude's like, no, 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 no. There's an instinct to not upset the herd. I'll get like one good punch in and chances are, you know, people will pull me or pull us away from each other before anything really bad happens. And of course in the movie, that's not what goes down. But that's how, I mean, it's like a built-in safety net. He can just run up, punch Izzy, and then security's going to keep anything worse from happening. Why not grab Izzy and Axel's attention right then and there and say, listen to me right now. I'm going to bring my wife, Charisse, to a place that our management will decide on. You're going to apologize to my fucking wife for what you did and own up to it. And if you don't, I'm never going to stop chasing after you and whooping your ass, but you've got 1 week, right? Something like that. And then they could hash it out. Whoa, whoa, whoa. What are you talking about? Izzy might not remember that he did what he did, or he might say he didn't do it. They might say your wife's not trustworthy. I mean, it certainly sounds to me like Vince in his own background story describes his wife as being someone that was a real hassle to him and had a lot of unhealthy tendencies. Maybe she's not totally believable. I don't know. Maybe someone did that to her, but it wasn't Izzy Stradlin, for all we know. Maybe Izzy did it and he's a piece of shit. I mean, I'm fully on board with that. If that's totally believable to me that Izzy could be enough of a piece of shit when he was wasted before he got sober to treat somebody like that and make them feel, you know, terrible and abused in public. So I don't want to believe that, but I don't have to believe it one way or the other. It's still one person's word against everyone else's word. And no one else is backing up Charisse's story. He's just believing what she said. Eh. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe there's some account of like Ricky Rackman, who I think he was the owner of the Cat House, coming out and saying he saw it take place and he helped, I don't know, cover it up back then or something. But he's now bravely stepping forth to take Charisse's side. Who knows? But the end of this chapter in Vince's book, I'll skip over some of the more redundant details about, you know, challenging Axel to a fight. You know, he says, Big Mouth Axel never responded. My offer still stands. I'm sure Dr. Buss would help us get into the Staples Center if we wanted. Dr. Buss is like a friend of his that he owns the Lakers. I don't think anyone is interested in what it would take to fill up the Staples Center for these two goofy, broke down rock singers to duke it out in front of everybody. In front of the, I don't know, 500 people that would show up. Now, I've only got one more piece of resource, one more piece of reference material to pull from. And I know I've been treating this like the Kennedy assassination. I don't care. This is my boy. This is my boy, Izzy. I have to mine all the information I can out of this stone, out of this shale, out of this crypt, if you will, of ancient rock and roll tales and scandals. Just a few quotes. I'm skipping the stuff that you've already heard because a lot of it is recycled because there's the same quotes from Vince. There's, in this case, though, some story from Alan Niven, the one time, Guns N' Roses manager. This is taken out of the Classic Rock Magazine Special Edition, Guns N' Roses Complete Story. So your ears don't get too fatigued hearing the same scenario over and over again. I'll back up in the timeline a bit to the infamous Wizzy incident. I realize that not everybody grew up with Kurt Loder and MTV News and the dulcet tones of Mr. Kurt Loder ringing in your ears with, like, you know, the recounting of the incident that prompted the band to nickname him Wizzy. So in this incident, Mr. Izzy Stradlin. August 27, 1989, he was on a U.S., you know, flight, and it was supposed to be in first class. Alan Niven says he was flying from Indiana to L.A., and because he'd been playing rough with his, you know, dogs, he had gotten bitten on the face with one of his dogs getting, you know, the way that they do sometimes, certain kinds of dogs. and, you know, had marks, you know, some scratches and stuff on his face. And the airline supposedly decided he wasn't presentable enough to fly in first class, for which he had paid his ticket. Maybe. I suppose. I don't know. I don't know what it was like in 1989 for that kind of thing. But, yeah, maybe they did the, sir, maybe you'd be more comfortable back here. I don't know. But, you know, if you're a rich young rock star, you can kind of, maybe he just didn't tip anybody when they started to give him a story. And if he had, he might have been able to go up first class. But that does stink of like a manager trying to make something up, like when you're making up a story for your friend who totally didn't do anything wrong when he get in trouble. But, you know, in like junior high, like, I don't know how it got that way. We didn't do anything. He just fell off of it, you know. And, but he says they put him back in coach, but they gave him as much liquor as he wanted as fast as they could get it to him. So they get him loaded. And at one point, he goes to use the bathroom, can't get in, and just decides he's not going to wait any longer. And he starts whizzing in the magazine rack. According to FBI agent R. Scott Rivas, he stated, "I'm not waiting any longer," and unzipped his pants and urinated in the galley area in front of several passengers and a flight attendant. If only he had been up in first class, he would have had access to another bathroom. See what you get. Izzy says that was his low point where you kind of bought him out. I said, "Hey, I got to change. This isn't working for me anymore." So I got sober. Alan Niven says, "Of all of them, Izzy found the celebrity and fame the most tiresome and worthless, and it constricted his rock and roll heart. It amuses me how little attention he draws, yet to me, he was the heart and soul of the band, an embodiment of the rock and roll attitude." So, the next section of this part of the magazine, which is called The Year of Living Dangerously, says, "More chaos awaited GNR at the MTV Music Awards, September 1989. And let me double check that date again. Yeah, August 27 was the flight. So in September, tensions already existed between the band and Sunset Strip rivals Motley Crue, but things got worse when Izzy allegedly made a pass at Crue frontman Vince Neil's wife, Cherise Riddell, at LA club The Cat House. Neil decided to take revenge at the MTV Awards. And earlier in the episode, on a segment that I recorded, oh, I don't know, a month ago or more than that, I was saying she was at the Tropicana, and that's my mistake. I've already, I believe, corrected it. It's, you know, but she was a mud wrestler at the Tropicana is why I was thinking that. And this incident happened at the Cat House. So, Cherise's own words stay right in line with the established story, which, you know, credit to her, credit to everyone. But that's her story. She's sticking to it. If that's what happened, that fucking sucks. And I hate that that happened to her. And no one should have to feel like that. And no one should have to go through this, especially a teeny tiny little woman who is a public performer and entertainer who is being abused because of, you know, her sort of gender and status as an exotic dancer. But she says, "I was at the Cat House and Izzy was hitting on me. He was all fucked up. I told him to get his hands off me because I was Vince's wife. Then he grabbed my shirt and pulled it down. I slapped him across his face and he karate kicked me as hard as he could in the stomach. He knocked the wind out of me and everyone saw it." Again, she's the only person that's ever told this story other than Vince Neil telling it in the exact same way that she told him. Everyone saw it, but no one's coming forward. It feels like, with all that happened afterwards, there should have been one other voice at least to either say, "Yep, I was there and I fucking saw it. That's exactly what went down." That would make me feel better about I don't know, I guess judging somebody I wish wasn't a woman abuser. So then at the MTV Awards, Niven says Guns N' Roses played Free Fallin' with Tom Petty. Afterwards, now I'm going through this all because this telling of the story is different. The MTV Awards part of the story is different than what we've heard so far on this episode of A History of Rock and Roll and Film and Rock and Roll. We're walking off the brightly lit stage into the darkness to our left, and suddenly Vince comes running over and popped Izzy in the face. Then there's a quote from Vince we've already heard about him looking like Eric Stoltz and mask after he punches him. He fell to the ground. I decked him, blah, blah, blah. I'm awesome. The Tom Petty quote, Vince Neil comes running out of the wings and decked Izzy, hit him right in the face. Our sound guy, Jim Linehan, was walking off the stage with us. And Linehan was like, I don't even know this Izzy kid, but he's with us. So he decked Vince Neil. Izzy was getting a lot of black eyes in those days. I think he'd already had a black eye before Vince hit him. I assume that might have been in the scuffle with the air marshals or airport security when they got off the plane on the 27th of August, whatever it was. Niven says, I grabbed Vince, put him very quickly on his back on the floor. My left hand was around his throat, and my right hand was cocked and ready to smash his nose. And I actually had a fleeting moment of intelligent thought, where I went, if I do this, this is not going to be good. So I let him up. Viriki is a person who's on the staff. I got to find out who that person is. Another observer. Oh, it's a Guns N' Roses PR person. Arlette Viriki, from 87 to 91. He says, they were all chasing to beat up Vince for punching Izzy, but they didn't catch him. He got away. But that was all over Izzy's screwing Vince Neil's girlfriend. Who knew they were that picky? Before we reached the exit, Axel came snarling after us like an overdressed Doberman. We heard that part already. Come on, motherfucker, let's go. I said this, and he squeaked like a little bitch. Just don't fuck with my band, blah, 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 blah. So, kind of an accusation that there might have been a consensual thing between Izzy and Charisse, and maybe she got caught, and she made up a story about Izzy assaulting her? I don't know. I don't need to believe it. It is what it is, but it's another person's story from inside that group, you know. And I want to now go to a bit with Mick Wall of kErRaNg, who has told the story of this tumultuous time and his sort of, you know, experiences being at the beck and call of Axl Rose after this incident in particular. Now, if you've heard me in previous episodes that concern the works of Mick Wall, just like Stephen Davis, I find the writing to be good some places, exciting and sort of harrowing and what seems like an interesting account of things and that I trust. Other times, hacky. Other times, lots of filler. Lots of inserting themselves into the story for no good reason other than to fill out pages. And I just want to sort of put that back out there before I read this part. I tend to take Mick Wall's side in this scenario. I tend to believe what he's saying from his point of view because there's enough precedent for this sort of erratic behavior and, you know, maybe not remembering what one said a little while later after one said it on the part of Axl Rose and other members of Guns N' Roses. So he talks about, you know, getting stuff together between the years 87 and 90 when it comes to his ever-growing pile of quotes and interviews with members of Guns N' Roses. And then he'll get into the Vince Neil stuff and the Motley Crue stuff. But I want to read the part of this article that sort of precedes it where he mentions, you know, the mention of him in Get in the Ring, ripping off the fucking kids, printing lies, starting controversy. You want to antagonize me, motherfucker. He says, let's see, 7 years on from being accused by Axl Rose in Get in the Ring, whenever anybody asks why my name came up in that appallingly funny song, I thought that song was badass when I was young. I think it still is. Except if you take out all the like yelling at journalists, it's a badass tune. I mean, I never quite know what to say. It's like being asked why you broke up with your girlfriend. Like, how much time do you have? I've heard the rumors, of course. So first off, let me begin by straightening out some of the most popular misconceptions. Number one, Axel threatening to kick my bitchy little ass was not because of his reaction to the book I wrote about the band, Guns N' Roses, the most dangerous band in the world. The song was recorded long before that book was published. Two, getting my name in a Guns N' Roses song did not result in me losing my job in kErRaNg, the magazine which had printed many of my GNR stories. I had already decided to leave some months before the Use Your Illusion 2 album was released, as friends and colleagues will confirm. Three, despite Axel's assertions, I have never ripped off anybody's children or deliberately told lies in anything I have written about Guns N' Roses. So what was it all about? Well, on one level, Get in the Ring is just a lot of L.A. puff about nothing. A big, teary, hair-pulling tantrum from an overindulged child star shouting and swearing because he can't get his own way. So Guns N' Roses got some bad write-ups in the press, so what? Name one band anyone's ever heard of that didn't. The accusation that certain members of the press had made things up is a more serious one, perhaps, but hardly new. Again, and name one celebrity that hasn't made that claim. Did I make things up, though? Do me a favor. What for? Oh, sorry, he's British. Do me a favor. What for? The Gunners were the oasis of their day, and the whole beauty of writing about them then was that there was always so much going on. Slash and Duff were always the most amenable, a great double act when partying, and the most accepting of the idea of success. They had their moments of confusion and despair, like anybody who lived in a goldfish bowl would, but on some deeper level they both understood that it was no less than they had expected. They didn't get into bands not to be rock stars. This was what it was all about, dude. And we did a number of excellent interviews together between 1987 and 1990. I'd seen Axel around a fair bit, too, whenever I stayed in L.A., which was most of the time by the late 80s. But we never really got up close and talked. We both sort of knew we'd get around to doing something together one day. You don't need to talk to me yet anyway, he had once remarked. You're doing a pretty good job getting it all from Slash. Elsewhere in all the quotes in this magazine, you know, people mentioned that Axel was really kind of shy and intimidated and he couldn't keep his shit together. He had a lot of stage fright. He had a lot of things just having to be his way before he could feel natural. And he felt like Slash was getting all the attention. He didn't feel Axel like he was an attractive person or the kind of person people would, you know, look up to the way that they did Slash. Which, you know, Slash just hangs behind his hair and his hat and, like, bangs away on his guitar, being cool, not getting out and screaming at people, not, you know, chewing out Paul Stanley for being in the audience at one of their club shows and not chewing out David Bowie for being in one of their club shows and screaming and making a big ordeal out of everything. So maybe that's why people are more likely to approach someone like Slash. And Duff. So anyways, Mick Wall goes on to say, I left it at that. Part of my act back then was never to hassle anybody, just let them know I was around and leave the 2+2 to them. It usually worked, too. And as I was to discover, in some respects at least, Axel was no different than any other rock star. Fast forward to January 1990 and a phone call just as I'm getting ready to hit the sack. It's Axel wanting to know if I can come over to his place right now. Because he has something important to say. At the time, he was living in a small two-bedroom apartment in West Hollywood, and when I got there, he was raving. It was all about Motley Crue singer Vince Neil, who he claimed had jumped Izzy from behind and roughed him up a couple of nights earlier. The argument was over Vince's wife, who'd claimed Izzy had come on to her, while Axel now insisted it was the other way around. And then it was Vince's wife, a former mud wrestler at the Tropicana, who had made a pass at Izzy. Or something. It was a lot of nothing about nothing, but Axel was mad. He was going to make Vince pay. He was ranting about how he wanted to kill that motherfucker. He chundered on for a full 10 minutes before he finally calmed down, long enough for me to set up the tape recorder. I don't know what that means, like 10 minutes to... A tape recorder, you put a tape in the tape recorder and you press the record and play button at the same time. Axel screaming and yelling, you get the tape recorder out, motherfucker. Axel could tell you to stop if he wants. Okay? You go ka-chunk on the two big buttons there. The red one and the black one with the triangle on it that means play. He was saying crazy things, fantasizing about what he was going to do to Vince once he got a hold of him. So before the interview began, I sat on the couch and scribbled down some of the things he had said so that I could throw them back at him in the interview, including some astonishing statements like, any way you want to go, guns and knives, motherfucker, and a few other choice phrases. Then we sat down and began taping. Once Axel had got his Vince spiel off his chest, not only did he end up giving me a full two-hour interview, but he also let me do a second, more staged interview for Capital Radio, where I used to present a Saturday night show. We did sort of a mini Desert Island Discs together. That's a show on NPR. I assume it's been around for decades. I've only heard it from the 2000s onward. I don't know if they still even do it, but Desert Island Discs, maybe it originated somewhere besides NPR. I don't know. But it's just an interview where it's like, hey, if you were trapped on a deserted island and you could only have this many songs to listen to, what would they be? That's how I got into Steve Earle, because King of the Deathmatch pro wrestler Mick Foley talked about Steve Earle on that, on an interview I heard on NPR. I'm a classy guy. He got to pick some of the tracks that affected him the most as a child. Jamaica by Led Zeppelin and Benny and the Jets by Elton John were two that he picked. It was a great interview. Afterwards, he was in such a good mood, he even taped a couple of station IDs for me. Those are the ones where it's like, well, I mean, the young folks, you don't probably hear these. But in the day, I bet there's compilations on YouTube of them now, though. You could probably find a ton of them. I bet someone's like taped, like edited a bunch of them together. like, hey, this is Axl Rose, and you're listening to K-Rock on 90.7, your dick and my mom's ass. There's some great old Van Halen ones from the Seattle rock station KSW that they'd play on special occasions from back in like early 80s. You know, they'd all be singing a cappella, harmonizing like a barbershop quartet. And we're Van Halen, and you're listening to KZOK or KISW or whatever the heck it was at the time. So let's see. He writes the things down. Then he tries to give the full flavor of how menacing Axel had sounded during the early part of the visit and included all the controversial comments he made on tape, plus one or two of the things I'd written down that he had said when I first arrived, and he was still on a roll. But when I read it back, I realized how heavy some of the things that Axel had actually said looked in black and white. So I decided that, to be on the safe side, I should contact him in case he had changed his mind or wanted to lighten it up a little. We spoke on the phone. Mick, why did you not record this on your tape recorder? And I explained my fears to him and asked if he wanted to retract any of the more inflammatory quotes. He just laughed and said, no, man. I still stand by every fucking word. But when the interview ran as a cover story in April 1990, I'm assuming in kErRaNg magazine, it immediately caused uproar in both the Motley Crue and Gunner's camps, and suddenly it was nothing to do with Izzy anymore. Coming from the same town, the two bands ran in many of the same circles. Crue bassist Nikki Sixx and Slash had once been big pals and shared many of the same friends and business acquaintances. Does he mean like drug dealers? Or does he mean business acquaintances? Like accountants? Like they're not the ones booking shows and doing promo and, like, marketing. What does that mean? Or prostitutes? Maybe he means prostitutes. Maybe he means prostitutes and drug dealers simultaneously. By making such a confrontational public statement, Axel may have briefly got to Vince Neil, but he'd also started something no one else in either band would have wanted. He had started a war. And my feeling is that it was at that very moment that Axel realized what he had done, that he first began to turn against me in his mind. Nothing was ever his fault. If something had gone wrong, it must have been someone else's fuck-up, or, in this case, mine. The first intimation I had of the trouble brewing was when Axel got one of his flunkies to call and ask me to send them a copy of the interview tape so the band could run it on their own special Guns N' Roses telephone line in America. My suspicions were immediately aroused. This is another thing that you young folks and older folks didn't grow up with. There's a short time in rock and roll history where they would, you know, all kinds of celebrities and sometimes rock stars would gouge their fans, whoever could get their hands on their parents' credit card or whatever, and or, you know, just bill it to their home line, their, you know, phone company, AT&T or MCI or whatever. And for every minute you spent listening to a recorded message, because you're such a big fan, you know, you would get charged probably a couple bucks per minute. Why on earth would they want to run that interview on a phone line? I mean, if like someone's 12-year-old kid in America could just get on the phone and hear Axel like swearing up and down about all the like horrifyingly violent things he was going to do to Vince Neil with a knife. That would be a problem. That would be a problem instantly around the country with parents groups protesting and stuff. That would be a great story on MTV News the next day. When I asked what the number of the phone line was, there was a lot of spluttering and backpedaling down the other end, and that's when I knew something was up. Axel didn't want the tape so he could run it on a phone line. He wanted it so he could listen to it, so he could see if he'd really said all the things I'd reported he'd said. When I refused to send the tape and confronted one of Axel's publicists with my views, she admitted that there was indeed a problem. Axel, she said, just can't believe he said some of those things. He doesn't even think he would speak that way. He thinks it's kind of funny. Kind of funny. At first, I was gobsmacked. Later, the more I thought about it, the more completely outraged I became. For years, I had always done my damnedest to play fair with Guns N' Roses. There had always been a great many unsavory occurrences that I had been witness to over the years that had never come within a million miles of publication. Personal problems that Slash had approached me for advice on. 3 a.m. confessions that Duff swore me to secrecy over. As far as I was concerned, I had proved myself. I was no stitch-up merchant. I was a friend. Now came this. Axel with his knickers in a twist because his big mouth had gotten him into trouble again. But why the subterfuge? If he wanted to hear a copy of the tape, why hadn't he just called and asked for one? Why did he have to get someone to call and invent some story? What did he have cooking? Axel, on an ill-tempered bender, was a crazy man, capable of almost anything. I played the tape back to myself and checked my notes. It was all there. I thought about making a copy of everything and sending it to him. But then I began to get paranoid. Surely he wasn't that far out. He didn't remember saying some of those things. But rock stars can convince themselves of almost anything. There's always plenty of people around who will tell them that they're right, no matter what they say or do. And I wondered if he wanted a copy of the tape so that he could, well, doctor it in some way. It sounds ridiculous, I know, but there were a lot of ridiculous things and people surrounding Guns N' Roses in those days. I thought that anything might be possible. Yeah, that's tough. Because today, just you send them a copy of the audio file and then you record yourself on video on your webcam, listening to the recording yourself, put it up on YouTube and go, there it is in real time, unedited. You know, if anyone says otherwise, they've doctored it and you'll hear where the edits are if they change it. But back then, the Guns N' Roses camp could say whatever they wanted to their fans and the fans would believe it. So, you know, it does make me a little suspicious that he refused to give over a copy or even just a copy of that section. But I don't know. I wish he could provide some sort of a specific example of how it maybe, you know, what he was thinking in his head or how it had been done to someone else in the past or friends of his that it had happened to if they had gotten screwed by that kind of behavior. But the problem with Axel's attitude is exactly the way he laid it out. I mean, he was a friend to Slash and Duff. He had done things to cover up for them. He had never done anything to prove to Axel that he was a good guy that would watch his back. And Axel's a highly suspicious person at this point. Maybe still. I don't know. And Axel's not alone in this world when it comes to people who can't just come out and say what they want and ask for something that should be pretty reasonable. Can I come over to your place and sit down and you play the tape for me? I think that would be totally reasonable. I think both men would agree to that should be fine. But like, he's the guy that has to make up a lie and this like weird scenario to like wrap up the pretense of why he wants the tape that he didn't ask for before. Because he knows he's wrong. Probably. Mm-hmm. And he gets caught in a lie. Probably. Mm-hmm. Pretty sure I told the story on the previous episodes of Guns N' Roses about, you know, him needing, you know, him being detained at the Canadian border during the tour during the 2000s or 2010s with, you know, Helmet and him and Paige Hamilton from Helmet sitting alone in a cell. And him sitting there, like, looking at the floor for a long period of time before he could think of a reason to come over and sit down, talk to Paige Hamilton, instead of just saying, hey, how's the tour going? Because you're opening for us on this tour, and we've never talked, you know. He had to say, like, I know a guy that knows you. He used to be a guitar tech. I think he's your guitar. Was he your guitar tech? And then he calmed down after Paige Hamilton said, yeah, that's my guy. I love that guy. And then, oh, yeah, great, he relaxed. He couldn't just walk out. It had to be set up in his head first. There had to be some sort of a frame around this, you know, some pretense. Again, I keep using that word for starting a conversation with another human being. Now, for a guy who keeps talking some trash about Mick Wall over the last couple of years. Well, I found another telling of a piece of this story we've gone over once. And, oh, it actually expands even more. And it seems to be a bit more favorable to my guy Izzy, if we are to believe the words that have been said in the part I'm about to reference, which goes to show what a duplicitous rat fank turncoat, two-faced, disingenuous piece of shit I am when it suits me, when it might clear the name of my boy, Izzy Stradlin, in my own mind, in my own heart. So this is straight out of Mick Wall's book, Last of the Giants, his most recent biography of Guns N' Roses. And he talks about the incident where he got called and was told, Axel wants to talk to you right now. And the PR person that he'd been like living on, I guess living with in LA, said, you know, you've got clearance to go over to the apartment where he is. And, you know, he goes in, they immediately go downstairs. Axel starts, you know, going off, right, in the way that we've already discussed. This little two-page bit has a couple of extra details, and Axel's summary of what maybe happened. Another supportive narrative that Izzy did no wrong. It says, you know, what came next was pure Axl Rose, circa 1990. Part hubris, part passion, part pain, part ludicrous hyperbole. The whole incident was bullshit, he ranted. Guns or knives, motherfucker, I don't care. I just want to smash his plastic face. This last, a sarcastic reference to Vince's then-recent, supposedly hush-hush cosmetic surgery. I can't believe this shit I just read in kerRaNg, he snarled, holding up a copy of kerRaNg dated 4 November 1989, and yanked open a page from John Houghton's interview with Motley Crue. The interviewer asks Vince Neil about him throwing a punch at Izzy backstage at the MTV Awards. Music television, don't you know, darling? And Vince replies, and then this is Axel reading it aloud sarcastically, I just punched that dick and broke his fucking nose. Anybody who beats up on a woman deserves to get the shit kicked out of them. Izzy hit my wife a year before I hit him. And Axel says, well, that's a crock of shit. Izzy never touched that chick. If anybody tried to hit on anything, it was her trying to hit on Izzy when Vince wasn't around. Only Izzy didn't buy it. So that's what that's all about. He continued ranting as I set up the tape recorder. Vince's wife has got a bug up her ass about Izzy. Izzy doesn't know what's going on. Izzy doesn't fucking care. But anyway, Izzy's just walked off stage. He's momentarily blinded, as always happens when you come off stage, coming from the stage lights straight into total darkness. Which was when he said Vince came out of nowhere and hit Izzy. Tom Petty's security people jump on him and ask Alan Niven, our manager, who had his arm around Izzy's shoulders when Vince bopped him, if he wants to press charges. He asks Izzy, and Izzy says, "Nah, it was only like being hit by a girl," and they let him go. Meantime, I'm walking way up ahead of everybody else, and the next thing I know, Vince still comes flying past me like his ass is on fire or something. All I saw was a blur of cheekbones. He carried on like this about how he wanted to see that plastic face of his cave in when I hit him. So I guess the plastic surgery, you know, he's alluding to might have been a little bit of facial sculpting, I guess, around the cheekbone area. And as obviously that it, whatever was done held up pretty nicely for a few years. Not so much, you know, the next 30 after that. Are you serious about this? I asked him. He said he was. There's only one way out for that fucker now, and that's if he apologizes in public, to the press, to kErRaNg, and its readers, and admits he was lying when he said those things in that interview. Personally, I don't think he has the balls, but that's the gauntlet, and I'm throwing it down. We sat down in the only two available chairs, not smothered in magazines, ashtrays, Coke cans, barf balls, more ashtrays. What are barf balls? Is that an English thing? Are there things from the late 1980s that the English refer to as barf balls? Like hairballs? Like did Axel have a lot of cats, I guess? Don't know. I doubt Mick Wall will ever want to be interviewed by me. But if you can talk to him for me, please ask him what barf balls are. And tell him I'm a nice person, and I think he's a very good writer. And I would totally hang out with him anytime. Tell him I'm dying of cancer or some other such disease, and I only have a couple of weeks to live, and let him hang out with me, please. I could tell him he's awesome and hope that he never listens to any of my criticism of him. Axel sat perched on the balcony window overlooking the pulsing neon ooze of the Hollywood Hills. the pulsing neon ooze. Oh God. I don't know if that's good or not. It sounds bad to me, but pulsing neon ooze. If that was like from a Blade Runner novelization, I would accept it, I guess. He lit another cigarette and waited for me to begin. So that's where the tape recording starts, supposedly, and the actual, you know, what he alluded to earlier, it was the whole, like, okay, then he calmed down enough that we could get started for real. And then we had more of a talk that was a bit professional, and even though Axl Rose being pissed off, you know. I mean, he's not interviewing Daryl Hall and John Oates, for crying out loud. It's an Axl Rose interview, so it's going to be... Even if it's professional, it's going to be provocative, I'm sure. So there we go. I think I'm done analyzing the Izzy Stradlin, Vince Neil, Axl Rose incident from every angle now. I hope you feel better. I hope you feel complete. I don't. I never will. Not till I can meet Izzy. Have him ask me who the fuck I am and why I'm talking to him someday, perhaps. Or Charisse, maybe. That was her name, right?
Don't forget to visit our refreshment center during the intermission or any time. You love the tasty array of snacks we have to offer. So will the youngsters. Everything is quality and so good.
Now back to some more tropes from Dirty Harry the Deadpool. The next one is plagiarism in fiction. In this case, it says subverted, Harlan Rook rages that Peter Swan stole the ideas of his films from Rook, so his killing spree is justified revenge, but it's quickly revealed that Rook is just plain delusionally nuts. Preemptive declaration. The film has this during the Chinatown restaurant robbery scene. Harry Callahan, you forgot your fortune cookie. Lead robber turns, what? Harry gives a smug grin and pulls out a fortune. Harry Callahan, it says, you're shit out of luck, shoots the lead robber. Prima donna director, the egotistical horror film director Peter Swan. Red herring, for most of the film, it looks like egotistical horror director Peter Swan is the Deadpool killer. But at the end, the real killer turns out to be Harlan Rook, a crazed fan of Swan's. Before the talk show host is murdered via car bomb, a man recently fired by Swan is seen at a hardware store wearing a Hotel Satan jacket. Because that's Hotel Satan is the movie that Liam Neeson's character is making. Watching him on some in-store TVs and buying some stuff that could be used to make a bomb. Or if it's not the one he's making, it's one he's made in the past. I forget. He's still wearing the jacket, though. Rule of three. While investigating the death of a drug-abusing rock star, Harry's partner Al Kwan states his personal belief that celebrities always die in threes. Self-immolation. Harry, with the help of Samantha, diffuses a situation where a guy demands cameras film him setting himself on fire. Almost through here. Shout out the chase scene with the explosive RC car, which we've mentioned. Shout out to the chase scene in Bullet. The calling for an ambulance in advance stunt is from the New Centurions. Next one. Take that, critics. Molly Fisher, the film critic who becomes the second murder victim, is based on Pauline Kael, K-A-E-L, in response to her accusing the first film of promoting fascism. Also see most of Lady in the Water by M. Night Shyamalan. Villain opening scene. Before we see Harry, we first see Rook in his apartment watching the news and reading a Rolling Stone magazine while making the Deadpool list, though his face is obscured during the scene. Okay, but now I've got to read from the slash entry in tvtropes.org. It says music. There's a music section, I guess, specifically, and it says slash musician. Born Saul Hudson on July 23rd, 1965, in Hampton, London, England, considered to be one of the greatest guitarists in the world and his generation's most famous guitarist. Slash is best known as lead guitarist in Guns N' Roses. After leaving the band in 1996 due to disagreements with Axl Rose, Slash played in the supergroup Velvet Revolver until it disbanded. If you're like a big, you know, a follower of Slash and follower of guitar stuff, of course, you're probably screaming right now because of certain things that were already said. I understand. There's a lot more to the story. Blah, blah, blah. Yeah, Velvet Revolver, solo albums, Miles Kennedy and the Conspirators, reunion with Axl Rose, blah, blah, blah. Not in this lifetime tour. Nice little paragraph at the end of this, the preliminary part of the page. Not to be confused with Slash Fic. Though there probably is some overlap somewhere. yep, there probably is. And if you don't know why I'm laughing, I don't know. Go to tvtropes.org and look up Slash and then click on the links for Slash Fic. And some overlap and Guns N' Roses. Anyways, even though he's not a movie or a TV show, he's got his own entry of tropes. Slash gives examples of cool old guy, certainly becoming this as he's still kicking ass in his mid-50s. The fact that he doesn't look his age certainly helps. Cool shades, occasionally wears black sunglasses. Occasionally? Dented iron. At one point, he ingested so much drugs and alcohol, he had to be put on a pacemaker in 2001 because his heart had swollen so large. He is not very well written. I'll grant you that, but the point's there. He's fine now, and the batteries in the pacemaker have worn out, so he's opted not to remove it. That's interesting. There was a quote from Lemmy when he had his sort of heart operation, and he got one put in, a defibrillator put in as well, and it's like he's like, I had a conversation with Slash on the phone. He called me up to tell me all the things that I should or shouldn't do with the defibrillator in, which, you know, apparently fibrillate is one of those things. iconic item, along with his top hat and sunglasses, his Les Paul guitar. When Gibson released a signature series, Slash was impressed they replicated the one he used with every single nick, scratch, and cigarette burn my guitar has. Massive multiplayer crossover trope. Given that, like Santana, Slash doesn't sing, his self-titled album release in 2010 has everyone from Ozzy Osbourne to Fergie on vocals. Murder Ballad, 30 Years to Life. Obligatory Bondage song, World on Fire's title track. Older Than They Look. Doesn't look very different now than he did in the 90s. Only known by their nickname trope. It is extremely rare for him to be addressed by his birth name. He doesn't dislike it. It just becomes synonymous with him. It's just become synonymous with, well, his nickname has, yes, okay. Peek-a-bangs trope. His long curly hair often covers most, if not all, of his face. This is one I haven't seen or heard of before. Sesame Street cred. He's got credits on two Disney Channel animated properties. He recorded Kick It Up a Notch for Phineas and Ferb the movie Across the Second Dimension, and later made a cameo as a Battle of the Bands judge in an episode of Milo Murphy's Law. Some of you kids or parents, perhaps, know what any of that means. Three more. A signature headgear he is rarely seen without his iconic top hat. This is great. Actually, I won't read the last. The last one is like is just mentions that like Miles Kennedy is his lead singer and Todd Kearns every now and then sings a couple songs live. That's not a big deal. But the last one I'll really read. The last trope is smoking is cool. He used to smoke a lot and be commonly photographed with a cigarette hanging on his lips. He quit after his mother's death from lung cancer. Sorry, I shouldn't be laughing while I'm saying his mother's death from lung cancer. I'm still laughing at the first part. That smoking is cool is a trope. Oh my God. I want to see who's most attributed to smoking is cool. Let's see. They don't just have a list. There's a big list of examples, but you got to click on all those different pages and stuff. And they're not the specific people. Compare stealth cigarette commercial, smoking is glamorous, and cigar chomper. See also good smoking, evil smoking, contrast, smoking is not cool, and cigarette of anxiety. No, I got to read one paragraph from the smoking is cool trope page. In older media from before the Surgeon General's report on tobacco use, smoking conveyed maturity, experience, and social acceptability. The stop having fun guys character in an old movie or TV show will almost always be a non-smoker, as will the male neat freak and ambiguously gay, and the female maiden aunt, purity Sue, and straw feminist. Basically, the non-smoker was thought to be no fun at all, and unless they're a youngish purity Sue, socially transgressive in some way. The message was that most non-smokers were weirdos you didn't want to know, which might be part of the reason why people of that generation refused to believe the Surgeon General for so long. It seems like a classic case of, and this is another trope that you can link to, do not do this cool thing. This whole page is great, but I'm not going to waste your time with that. You can check it out on your own. Back to some Guns N' Roses chat.
We hope you'll make this a weekly visit. Bring the family. Bring your friends. There are always wonderful new pictures to see, delightful snacks to nibble, a gay, pleasant evening for all. Oh, a word of caution. Don't drive over 10 miles an hour in the theater area for your safety's sake. And Mom or Pop, go with the kids when they leave the car. We hope you have a wonderful time. Come back soon.
Now, lest you think I'm just doing the bare minimum of research by grabbing a few books here, I found old notes that I had prepped for this episode quite a while back, maybe as much as a year back, that revisiting them made me feel pretty good because... Every now and then I wonder, am I doing enough on the podcast? Am I cranking these out fast enough? Am I taking too long? Or am I doing this too sparingly? Am I taking too much time in between? And generally, you know, I'm not taking much time in between. I'm always working on something. There's some element of research I'm doing, even if it's usually not focused on whatever the next episode's going to be. And then people, I go back to notes like this and links that I've saved, and I find the first 50 gigs GNR on Twitter, It's news and updates for the first 50 gigs, Guns N' Roses and the making of Appetite for Destruction. And it turns out there's the top tweet on that account is, we want to give a big shout out and thanks to Ricky Rackman for welcoming our host Mark Cantor into his awesome podcast, Cat House Hollywood. In episode 25 of Cat House Hollywood Podcast, Ricky and Mark go way back to the earliest days of GNR, listen on Spotify and Apple. And then there's a cool image there of Mark and Slash from back in the day. And I went and checked out the First 50 Gigs podcast and the Cat House Hollywood podcast. And what I see on First 50 Gigs, Guns N' Roses and the Making of Appetite for Destruction. We got 10 episodes. Started in the end of July 2021, and they ended in July 2022. That's it. They're there for you if you want to check them out. They look to be about 35 to 55 minutes in length, most of them. Actually, most of them, it looks like 30 minutes. Yeah, they're almost all about 30 minutes long. So hopefully they said what they were going to say. I don't feel like listening to them all, but, you know, sometimes when podcasts go on a lot longer than that, they just suck. So I hope it was good. Ricky Rackman, Cat House Hollywood Podcast. I can see two episodes. May 7th, this says bonus. Motorhead and Lemmy Tales with Mickey D, 51 minutes. That's May 7, 2022. And then July 20th, 2022, episode 25, Guns N' Roses, way back in the day. Guest Mark Cantor, the one alluded to in the Twitter tweet. Can't find any info about the podcast on the cathousehollywood.com website. Not seeing it in Ricky Rackman's bio on Twitter either. I don't know, man. Because it seems like there was a bunch of episodes and now they're just taken down or they're hidden or something. Maybe they're mostly bonus or they're on Patreon, but I don't see advertisements for Patreon. Unless there's just some BS that I'm going on with Apple Podcasts and I'm not seeing it. But I was able to locate their podcast website. They're on libzin.com, just like I am. And no, the main feed just has those two, Motorhead and Guns N' Roses. So don't know what's up there. I'm sure Ricky's doing fine. Now for my final portion of the narrative of the Guns N' Roses story, let's go way back to 1986. In an article that appeared in Music Connection magazine in Los Angeles, California, written by Karen Burch. If you are a worshiper of Guns N' Roses, these are my words, not hers, you might want to bail before we get into the dramatized portion where me and my friends react in real time and read out loud the words of the band. It is, we get silly. So if that's going to piss you off, it's a good time to bail. But I will start by reading her preface to the article because she doesn't really, she doesn't really do the interview as you normally would. There's just headings and then there's quotes from the band. And you'll hear all of our different voices, and I will just say a heading, you know, A Rose by Any Other Name, and then we start talking. Like a Virgin, gigging for the very first time, and then we start talking. But her intro, and then I will read also the rebuttal and the rejoinders. Her intro starts here. Warning, do not mistake Guns N' Roses for a quiet, modest, or meek group of musicians. These guys are anything but. I'd heard the rumors. Everybody seems to be talking about this band for one reason or another. Trouble with their rehearsal studio / ex-living quarters, rape charges against members of the band, subsequently dropped, trashing the ladies' room at the Roxy during a night when the band wasn't even playing, Axel only broke a mirror. Word even had the boys were banned from the club, I assume. Not so, in parentheses. Guns N' Roses are W. Axel, with an E, or Axel, without the E, Rose, lead vocals, / lead guitar, Izzy Stradlin guitar, Duff McKagan bass, and Steven Adler drums. Are they this year's model of the perennial LA bad boy band? Could be. They seem to embrace that label and live it out to the fullest rock and roll degree. Never mind trying to hide the gory details that earn them that label. The five will explicate vividly upon topics you wouldn't even dare bring up. However, ask a question that Guns N' Roses don't want to answer and just watch them stiffen. Their eyes narrow, casting sidelong glances at each other and darts at the interviewer. The non-responses flew at me like, you know what hits the fan. That's a stupid question. We don't care about that. No one gives a fuck about that. Let's get on with the important shit. Fuck you and your magazine. Next question. Fine with me. Clearly, dealing with these guys takes great perseverance. One part iron will and two parts saintly patience, both with which I gird myself like a bulletproof vest. I chat with the band at their temporary home, official / unofficial manager, Vicky West's West Hollywood apartment. Vicky Hamilton's West Hollywood apartment, which is just a hop, skip, and a jump from the whiskey. Four of the members are currently fighting it out for the floors and the couch, while the fifth lives off campus. Walking into the small quarters, I conclude that Miss Hamilton must manifest that same saintly patience 24 hours a day, along with a large dose of plain old-fashioned caring, rare in these parts. No offense to Vicky, but the place resembles that certain phrase my mother used to yell at me when I hadn't cleaned my room. This place looks like a cyclone hit it. What was once intended as the dining area has become the band's storage space. Corners are adorned with guitars and its wall-to-wall amps. I dare not inquire where the drum kit is hidden. The guys camp here free of charge, so you'd think the very least they could do would be to take out the trash. And I get the feeling, though, maybe they aren't the domestic type. Ain't none of my biz. If this night is typical of others, the phone will ring every 5 or 10 minutes, usually one for the band, regarding God only knows. Example, the lead guitarist picks up the phone. Hello, Barbie, Christina? Yeah, this is / No, don't call here again. Slam. I hope for Vicky's sake, the guys don't have too many out-of-country friends. I'm sure the phone bill could pay the gross national debt. Sometimes they answer the phone Grand Central, which honestly couldn't be closer to the truth. Friends drop in intermittently during interview, plopping themselves down on the limited floor space. Peace and quiet, I fear, are rare commodities at this residence. I can't help noting the casualties of the evening because it all adds to the not-so-novel, time-worn bad boy image. Image, incidentally, is not one of Guns N' Roses' favorite topics. Same goes for the term label, not referring to record label. Come to think of it, the band doesn't go much for discussing record labels either. It's confidential, says / Casualties this night, at least those while I am privileged with their presence, turn out to be one huge, seemingly endless gallon bottle of cheap white wine. They're obviously on a tight budget here. A couple of packs of cigarettes. The interview is even stopped at one point for two members to go on a cigarette run. Vicky supplies the funds. Natch. The last is a true casualty, my tape recorder. When I excuse myself to go to the ladies' room, it seems that the band takes the opportunity to leave a little message, unprintable, as you might guess, on my machine. A nice sentiment, perhaps, and I'm flattered, but when I return, my deck simply refuses to operate. The eventual repair shop diagnosis, a burned-out motor. Is this what is referred to as an occupational hazard? For future reference, the tape recorder goes with me to the John. Not realizing the sad and final demise of my equipment, Guns N' Roses magnanimously furnish an alternate recorder so I can finish the interview. But don't think for a minute that their unceremonious sabotage of the tape recorder blemishes this writer's ability to remain objective. C'est la vie. As your narrator, I'm curious, like, how does a burned-out motor, how does that happen in the space of a trip to the bathroom? I mean, how do five guys burn out the motor? Like, I understand if they, like, smashed it, you know, if they smashed the motor, but I don't know how they, I mean, all right, whatever. Like, fast-forwarding and rewinding a lot until the motor burns out, I don't think they're that technically savvy when it comes to how to destroy a tape recorder without making it look like the tape recorder was destroyed unless they opened the back and, like, dumped some wine in it. I get that. Like, that I get. But, okay, whatever. Although I hate to focus solely on Axl Rose, the vocalist's personality certainly demands attention. Axl appears to be the creative force that drives the band. All the way through this, she's spelling it with an E. Soft-spoken and intensely serious, he prefers to converse mainly about the music. While the band refutes that there is any one leader per se, Axl emerges as the dominant figure, regardless of his mood. During the interview, Duff and Steven seem content to lay back and let others answer unless the two are specifically called upon. While Slash's role is that of the general troubleshooter and band mediator, and Izzy is the resident cynic, loudly shooting down my questions and shooting off his mouth. Go, Izzy. It becomes obvious early on that Guns N' Roses is one unit with five different personalities. There is, nevertheless, a single common denominator among the band members. Cockiness. Witness now the lives, loves, and pursuits of Guns N' Roses. It should be noted that this issue's cover and cover feature are running against the wishes of Guns N' Roses, according to W. Axl Rose. One final note from your narrator here. I watched the script like a hawk while we were all doing this, and I think the only thing that wasn't pronounced correctly was historic instead of what was written as histrionic, and I didn't want to break up the flow because somebody was on a roll. So I just kept my mouth shut and didn't feel like stopping to back it up because I didn't think it's that important because I could just say it now. You don't mind, do you? Okay, here's the main show. Here's the big finale. Here's the dramatization. If you have listened to my Crossroads episodes about the history of shred guitar, you would be familiar with the voices of Dan and Brian already. If you haven't listened to those, and you think they might be up your alley, you are correct. Now, if you listen to the My Friends and I Watch episodes involving the Bret Michaels movie or Metal Lords on Netflix, you're probably familiar with Jackie's voice as well as Dan and Brian's and mine, all while we're on the couch watching the movie and reacting in real time. If you haven't heard any of those, it's okay. Your life's about to be even better because I'm going to introduce you to my friends. These are all musician friends of mine that actively play, perform, rehearse, write stuff, you know. But this is also the part where I got to remind folks, we're not reverential about our treatment of the personalities in Guns N' Roses for this little exercise. So if you don't want to hear Axl being portrayed by a woman who's sounding verily la-di-da and girly, then this is your time to bail. Because that's what you're going to hear from Jackie. You're going to hear very, peppy, opinionated female voice. But then there's going to be when the spots where she switches over to Vicki Hamilton's voice. There's only two or three of those moments when you're going to hear Jackie go, come on, guys, be nice. That's the Vicki Hamilton part. Now, there's links to the entire transcript in the description section of this episode if you want to follow along or sort of demystify it. There's links in there to other ways you can support. There's the Patreon. Please check it out if you love rock and roll history. I guarantee you won't be disappointed. Now, let me play some samples of who's going to sound like what doing whom. You're going to hear Dan sounding like this as Slash.
Don't ask us where we're from.
Because Dan's a lead guitarist, and he thinks Slash is annoyingly overrated, so I made him do Slash. Now, Brian sounds like this.
Yeah, we don't care. I'm 19.
And he's a bass player, so I made him do Duff's parts on bass. And then you'll hear my voice doing two different parts. One is going to be Steven sounding like basically a golden retriever in human form.
We love to take care of women.
And he pops in only a few times here and there, but mostly when you hear my voice, it's going to be me doing Izzy Stradlin, who is the grouchiest of everyone, it seems, in the whole narrative. And I kind of decided to go, well, what would the guy who wrote the lyrics to and sang Double Talk and Jive or Dust and Bones sound like when he was fed up with the whole prospect of an interview before the interview even started?
We are 1, 2, 3, rolling! Okay, Guns N' Roses, 1986. Jesus. You can start, Axl.
A rose by any other name.
I came up with the band name. It was a combination of...
Peyote!
of names of previous bands. I was working with a guy who goes by the name of Tracy Guns, and I was Rose, so we became Guns and Roses. Tracy was replaced by Slash.
Axel has a fetish for guns.
Yeah, I really like that word.
And then Slash designed the Guns N' Roses logo.
Like a virgin, gigging for the very first time.
As of last June, this is Guns N' Roses.
Our first gig was...
The Troubadour, Thursday night. I'd rehearsed with the band for 2 days.
Yep, Thursday night at the Troop. We'd been playing a Tuesday and a Wednesday night with the old lineup, and we were building up slowly.
We had to eat shit to get where we are.
The Young and the Restless.
Sure, we'll reveal our ages.
Yeah, we don't care. I'm 19. Yeah!
No, Duff is 22 and I'm 19.
This really doesn't fucking matter.
Just tell her.
Axel isn't really 24. He's a million years old. He's seen everything.
Come on, go with the real ages here.
What's the bullshit with the ages? It doesn't matter to us.
Izzy's 23 and Steve's 21.
Just print that for the rainbow so they'll let us all in. Just
don't ask us where we're from.
Home is where you lay your head.
Seattle? No one is from Seattle.
How'd you find out I'm from Seattle?
Me? I'm not from London. I'm from Stoke-on-Trent. You wouldn't even know how to spell it, because I don't.
Fuck you and your magazine. There'll be no shit about me being from Indiana. It deserves nothing. It was a worthless fucking city. It's shit. Well, I'm from Hollywood, born and raised in America.
Can you print Indiana sucks?
Actually, I'm proud to be from Seattle.
And I'm proud of being from England.
The fact that I'm from Indiana has no business being in my career.
Yeah, it does. Just
say that the band is from Hollywood and that where they were born is unknown.
Glam Anonymous.
If I had to label this band, I'd say that it's a hard rock band with an R&B bass. It's not a glam band. It's not a heavy metal band. It's not a country band.
We listen to funk, disco, metal, classical. We listen to soundtracks, old blues things, 50s stuff, 60s music. We're influenced by all of it. We're not doing anything that I would call original. It's all been done before. We're not saying that we're starting or doing anything new. We're trying to be as sincere as we can with our music and just put it out the best way we can without claiming that we're the originators of anything. In other words, all our songs aren't going to be mellow. They're going to have a heavy edge to them.
Meaningless. We don't know what glam is.
I haven't got the slightest fucking idea.
We think it was started by some 70s bands.
People think that glam is anybody who has long, curly, or puffed up hair, earrings, fringes. Really, glam is nothing in particular.
Glam reminds me of bands like Angel that rely more on fashion than their music.
Glam is a label that doesn't apply to us. We don't need a label. Glam is nothing. It's a figment of your imagination. I write the songs.
We all write songs. I write the majority of the melodies, and we all work together on everything else. It's like we'll have 5 songs when we walk into a room to play. Whatever song that day has the most feeling and gets us all excited about it, that's the one we're gonna get. That's the one that's gonna get all the time put into it.
Axel writes all the lyrics, and we collaborate on the rest.
We write the songs in vans on our way to shows. Sometimes we write them when we're hanging out in the corner waiting for someone to buy a bottle, waiting for the alcohol. I just started one at the beginning of this interview.
If I can speak for everybody, the whole point of the band even being around is that we want our music to reach a lot of people. We want to be a worldwide exhibit. We don't have to be accepted. We just want to be a band that's out there.
Wearing his heart on his sleeve.
I live for the songs. If I go through a bad time, well, anything I have to go through is worth it if I've got a song out of it. If I had to sleep in a parking garage and I hated it and I wanted to give up, but I just kept going, then I got a song out of it from the experience. I'm so glad that I had to go through a ton of shit. I got a bitchin' song. When I'm on stage, that's when I get to take out what I'm worth to the public. I get to bring everything I've been working on for the past month, show the people my songs, and give that feeling to them. When I sing in a line, I'm thinking about the feelings that made me come up with the song in the first place. At the same time, I think about how I feel singing those words now and how those words are going to hit people in the crowd. I usually have to have someone stand beside me when I come off stage because I can't really even tie my own shoes. I've gone through so many thoughts on stage. You look out at a crowd of 700 people and you know 300 of them. This person loves you, this one hates you, and this one's mad at you because you owe him $5. And you're mad at another guy because he owes you $25. You see all this stuff, plus you're thinking about the feelings and the music. I try to put every single thought I possibly can into every performance and every line, and that's why I might be known as historic, because I go full out.
Yeah, we never lay back. We play at 110%.
If you're bored with a song and it's one of your songs, you just play it. It's like having a pair of pants.
It should be noted, our band has an inside joke about pants, and we wrote fucking a song about pants. Oh.
Those pants meant something to you at one time. Oh. You liked them or whatever.
You sure did.
But if you just outgrow them and you're tired of wearing them, it's like they're not you anymore. Some songs I rewrite because the verses aren't me anymore. I can come off stage in tears because I was so moved by the music. I want people to feel that too.
Talk of the town.
We're doing what we want to, and we're pulling it off.
We sell out every club in LA that we play.
I don't care if you think I've got a bad attitude or I'm being big-headed about it, but this is the only rock and roll band to come out of LA that's real, and the kids know it.
It's kind of a phenomenon. Their draw went from 150 to 700 almost overnight. I think it was their friends networking more than anything. It's definitely not advertising. It's word of mouth.
Before we started working with Vicky, we had no label interest.
At least if there was, we didn't know it.
Oh, Vicky. Yeah.
I brought Peter Philbin from Elektra to a Roxy show, and all of a sudden, everybody in the world wanted Guns N' Roses. Everybody started calling.
Till death do us part.
It's going to be hard to read this with a straight face. We're probably one of the only bands I know that don't hate each other all the time.
Yeah, never really fight.
We don't really have any friends outside of each other, the five guys in the band.
We are a family.
The sense of humor inside the band suits me fine. I don't have to go down to the comedy shop to get a joke. I can find that here. The comedy shop not being a real place.
Right.
Is the comedy store like the Walmart and the comedy shop is the 7-Eleven of comedy?
It's the ABC store of comedy. Yeah. When we go out, there's nobody else we would like to have more fun with. If one person's not here, then we just... fuck me. I'll try that one more time.
Take two.
When we go out, there's nobody else we would have more fun with. If one person's not here, and then they show up, it's like...
Great, you're here. Let's go. It's rape, pillage, destroy.
Rape, pillage, search, destroy.
That's our motto.
Wait, guys. I think we'll always be together as long as there's a spark between us.
Yeah, we'll be.
Till we die, and then some. And then we'll still be together.
Yeah, I mean, I love my dog.
But then he died, and now you have Steve. Hey!
And we don't share girlfriends.
Uh-huh. This is before the recording of the album.
Where the girls are.
At one point, most of us had girlfriends. And as soon as the band started happening, goodbye, they're a pain in the ass. They have too much time and they have their own ideas, which they're constantly throwing in your face.
I can hate it when women have their own ideas.
Oh no! Girls have their own ideas.
We believe in girls that are friends.
At this point in my career, it's easier for me not to have a girlfriend because I don't have the money right now to support a girlfriend. And they get tired of having to take you to dinner every day.
We love to take care of women. We love to treat them great. But right now, we don't have any money, so we treat them like shit. Except for Vicky.
Personal manager, professional babysitter.
I want to say this. Any band that's had the chance to work with Vicky and hasn't are idiots. She's done so much for us.
Ha 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 ha! He's the stroke machine. Vicky's the best.
We're leaving at her house, and she busts her ass 24 hours a day. She doesn't get to pay her rent because she spends all the money she can possibly get her hands on trying to get us off the ground. She was the only person that way back when we were doing our first gig, she said, "You guys are great. You're going to make it." I've got to tip my hat to her.
She's been doing all our Roxy shows, and we were dealing with her on the local level. She saw that we were getting a lot of interest after this one show we did, so she started just helping out by getting us hooked up with the label people. And we decided that we wanted her to manage us.
Now we have a lot more time to work on the music, our attitude. We don't have to deal with the bullshit. She works her ass off for us, but we're still very involved. Having a manager helps us relax a little and move faster.
Law and order.
If you sign with a label and they start telling you what to do and it's against you, then you tell them to fuck off. You're probably going to be up shit creek with lawyers and stuff. But at the same time, if that's what came down and how I believed, I guess I would go to be an unknown and live in Idaho. Guns N' Roses lawyer is Peter Paterno.
He'll sue anyone's balls right off.
Bad with a capital B.
We are.
We have no choice.
Trouble? All the time. That's why they're living here.
Wish I may, wish I might.
If I had one wish, I'd ask for a constant supply of Marlboros.
I wish it was 5 months from now, our album was out, and we were on the road, man.
Maserati four-wheel drive.
I don't think I like the question. It's ridiculous, because we're working on getting everything we want. I'd want all the money there is. I'd want power and control over everything there is. And third, I'd want all the wishes there are to have.
Power and control over everything there is. That sounds familiar. Axel's just another version of the Ayatollah.
Oh, no. I want peace of mind.
He really needs peace of mind, because when he was young, he had to go to the hospital and took a piece of it.
Louder, loudest.
Out of all the people we've talked with, we like Tom Zutout at Geffen.
The first thing out of his mouth when he had our first meeting was, "You guys are the loudest band I've ever seen in my life."
And we were playing soft.
That was an accomplishment coming from him as far as I was concerned. He said that the last band he'd seen that was this loud was AC/DC, and he's been doing this for years.
In Hollywood Rose, a previous band with Slash and Steve, we blew up the PA at Wong's West downstairs. People just grabbed their ears.
They couldn't hear for 2-3 days. Loud is a way of life.
The Music Connection Tour.
Why we deserve the cover of this magazine? To tell you the truth, I have no idea. Ask our manager.
Ask your boss. He should know.
Because we've created so much noise that we deserve to be on the cover of Music Connection.
The magazine is out for 2 weeks, right? It's going to be a 14-day adventure, like a Music Connection tour. We're going to play every 7-Eleven there is.
Thinking big for the future.
We'll get richer.
I'll have more pairs of shoes to choose from.
I'll have my own place to live.
All the socks we can buy.
Good work, everybody.
That was fun.
The cat shredding the paper in the background. Awesome. Great.
I just hear Steven now in my head, like Michelangelo of the Ninja Turtles, just like everyone else is serious about stuff. He's like, "Hey, I'm having a good time."
Yeah, Steven. What are you guys doing?
There's wickedness attempting to completely cover this nation in perversion and seductive, seducing spirits. I have never seen more images of more mermaids and water people in my life. That's a division in the kingdom of darkness, and they're highly technologically advanced. And we have to understand what we're dealing with. And we have to understand the rules of engagement in spiritual warfare. And we are meant for hand-to-hand combat. And we are meant to bring our cries before the throne of God to bring judgment on the rulers of darkness of this world and of this nation.
Now, at the end of the article, there is a postscript. It says, Guns N' Roses signed a record deal with Geffen on March 26, 1986. I hear tell that the band received a cool $37,000 as part of their advance. All five members were unavailable the next day. Their manager reported that the boys were out shopping, but this time for a deal of a different kind, on new equipment. My final word, hey, if you guys have any dough left, how about forking over $40 for a new tape recorder? If not, fuck you and your band.
Fuck you! You pizza shit! Fuck you!
Just kidding, I think. Okay. Then we have a response from Axel. It was published in Music Connection in August, and the original article came out in April. The interviewer, Karen Burch, has her own comment to the letter. So here's what it said in the magazine. Guns N' Roses versus Music Connection, the sequel. The magazine's most talked about story of 1986 was Karen Burch's no holds barred feature on the young LA-based group Guns N' Roses, April 14, which ran at the time of the band's signing by Geffen. As it turned out, we were forced to run the piece, quote, against the wishes of Guns N' Roses, according to lead singer W. Axl Rose, unquote. The story was published with this disclaimer because of a last-minute demand that we pull it along with the unacceptable cover photograph, which had been, in fact, approved by then-manager Vicky Hamilton and at least one band member. Burch's story elicited an unprecedented response from readers, all of it positive, until now. What follows is the complete text of a letter the magazine has received from Rose. Because of the somewhat accusatory nature of its content, the letter is followed by a response from writer Burch.
Fuck you! How dare you doubt me!
My dearest Music Connection, in response to your interview, cover photo, comments, letters, review, and article on band managers titled The Best Years of Their Lives, I'm writing you this letter. In my opinion, a California-based magazine would be better off being an ally to the LA diversities as a whole rather than writing the I know the industry, I am the only way, and you will bow before me attitude so many of the blind in the observation industry insist upon doing. Did it ever occur to you that I am trying to do exactly as I choose by the only road I have found? The music I take part in is by choice, not by an adherence to another's view of the quality or the sincerity of any given piece of material. Freedom of choice is a concept in which each member of Guns N' Roses shares a commitment. We are our own political party within a government, just as any small business. I realize in a world of particular reality where the pen acts and so often is in actuality as the knife, we all fall beneath the blade of personal opinion. No one escapes hypocrisy. The attitude of Guns N' Roses in contact is relatively simple to understand. Honesty and fulfillment of commitments to the best of abilities within the realm of our survival hold the key. In an attempt to communicate with us, you violated our basic laws of well-balanced relationship with any outside organization or individual for that matter. I will address these infringements individually and then proceed with my opinions of yours and others' opinions re Guns N' Roses. We, Guns N' Roses, agreed to an interview and consented to be the subjects of a cover photo for the Music Connection. This was done on the basis of a verbal agreement made by both parties, Guns N' Roses and the Music Connection. This agreement required the use of a tape recorder by the Music Connection in the interview. It also stated Guns N' Roses was allowed to review and edit said interview before printing. The agreement demanded that no photographic material of Guns N' Roses was to be used without the consent of Guns N' Roses. Music Connection representative Karen Burch agreed to these terms before interviewing Guns N' Roses. With the exception of the use of the unfortunate tape recorder, all promises were broken, leaving an I got the story, I got the pictures, fuck you and your confidences stench in the wake of the Music Connection in the lives of Guns N' Roses. No considerations or respect for Guns N' Roses was shown. Save for the sheer fact, we were noticed and given an opportunity to be seen in the press. It's a shame our first contact with the world as large as the press should leave such a foul taste in my mouth. In a world as large as the press. Okay. Regarding Guns N' Roses' attitude toward Karen Burch, before, during, and after the interview, she received what she asked for. Karen was welcomed into our environment eagerly. Outside interest was considered, perhaps wrongly, as a compliment. In consequence, our world was invaded, our requests for privacy, personal privacy, ignored. The unrecorded sexual prodding of the band by Karen Burch resulted in the accidental breakage of the reporter's tape recorder by Guns N' Roses. Responsibility for this incident is a matter in which I ask myself if I should accept. Perhaps under different circumstances I would, but as of now I won't. The letter you printed from a Dr. Scappa, 512, was quite amusing. I have never met this man, but I venture to say the idea of such an unwitnessed occurrence frightens him. This stamp out the object of fear mentality without exploration frightens me. It tends to give the victim of its attention the choice of becoming dangerous for the purpose of survival. The situation as a whole is a double-edged sword. In another letter, 6-9, a Steve Beck claims to know a couple of the members of Guns N' Roses. I don't know him, and neither do any of the members of this band. His comments are a farce. The editorial remark following Mr. Beck's letter is another example of blind journalism. The cover photo by Christine Dahlin is a hideous representation of the artist's abilities as a photographer. His insincerity and lack of personability responded in chaos in the studio. I do respect his ability to capture the attitude projected toward him on film. I apologize for not walking out. There is no acceptable excuse. The photographs of the individual members of Guns N' Roses used in the interview were taken by our photographer Robert John and used against our wishes by the Music Connection. The only photo approved for use in the interview by Guns N' Roses was the black and white group shot, also taken by Robert John. All right, rounding third here, heading for home, everybody. In regards to the comments made by Vicki Hamilton in your article, The Best Years of Their Lives, I would like to start by saying Vicki Hamilton is a kind, good-hearted person. There's a sizable list of tasks performed and duties completed by Vicki, none of which have been unappreciated. Vicki is exceptional in booking, promoting, and as she says herself, babysitting a band. Without her, the road would have been considerably rougher. Vicki, however, did not negotiate our record deal, plan or design band direction, or choose personnel in the Guns N' Roses organization. I would like to thank Screamin' Lord Duff for his review of the band. It seemed pretty spontaneous and genuine. I appreciate the honesty of his opinion. And oh yeah, Geffen did sign Aerosmith, didn't they? I would like to thank you, Music Connection, for your attention and your time. Rock and roll. Sincerely, W. Axl Rose, Guns N' Roses. Karen Burch responds. I can relate facts that clearly display Rose's less than personable spirit, as well as his numerous incidents which occurred after the interview took place. For example, his wholly uncooperative conduct during the photo shoot, the daily threats made by him up until the date in which the story was printed. But who really cares? I elected not to report those incidents as I felt they would be quite embarrassing to Rose and thus to his band. It is unfair to chastise an entire group for the actions of the individual. I find Rose's letter quite curious. What's the big deal? He received what many bands would be thrilled to experience. He got his band got a great piece, bitchin', to quote Rose, for their press kit, and a cover photo that is direct product and result of the band's degree and professionalism. Exactly what Rose is expected. I got a great story and a broken tape recorder. I'm not complaining. These things happen. I find Rose's statements regarding the unrecorded portions of the interview just as puzzling. The only periods when the tape wasn't rolling were those times at which band members wished to speak off the record. I turned off the tape in order to put the band members at ease while they related some incidents and opinions not for print. That was purely out of consideration and respect for Guns N' Roses' personal and professional privacy, exactly what Rose purports he didn't receive. I venture to say that the vulgar and unprintable, in the interest of good taste, message recorded on my tape by certain band members while I was out of the room suggests that Rose has attributed the sexual prodding that occurred to the wrong party indeed. And the only victim of actual prodding was an inanimate object. As for the foul taste in Rose's mouth, may I suggest he try a little soap to wash away what appears to be a severe case of sour grapes. And concerning any stench he's left with, perhaps it's merely the bad smell that plagues those who harbor a rotten attitude.
Yum, yum. It's time for a tasty and refreshing snack.
Yowza, but that was a lot. Yes, I could use a tasty and refreshing snack. I think we all could. I hope you appreciate the fact that Guns N' Roses is a multifaceted being. Not all good, not all bad. I simultaneously have come to understand better how difficult it was to exist as Axl Rose, but also how difficult it would be to exist as a person constantly in the presence of Axl Rose. And I don't think the American or European music press had a clue what was about to come at them in the next few years after this.
We promise to satisfy your hunger, your thirst, yeah. Your sweet tooth.
It's not going
to
be that.
Visit our refreshment center now.
That's not what... That's not what Guns N' Roses says to the press. It's gonna be more like this.
Fuck you! You piece of shit!
Nah, I would never say that sort of thing to you, my listener. I would say, do any of you live in India? Because The stats on the downloads show India being the second largest geographical sort of demographic that enjoys this show. And I keep saying it every episode that I remember to. I'll say it again. Are you actually listening from India? Or are you all just American perverts with VPNs? I really want you to tell me. Email me at justtheworstever@gmail.com. You can also email about other things, not you being a pervert as well. Maybe suggestions for movies to check in on, books to read, documentaries to look into. I am here for all your suggestions. Now, to remind you, we have no ads. We have no real financial support. I have no financial support from anyone else, especially now that I'm currently unemployed because of how terrible the economy is. Very, very suddenly, I will accept PayPal tips. There's a link in the description of this episode. I will also encourage you to share this with other people. Please do. I want to know I did something that somebody else was entertained by with my life and my energy and all that research I did. And I want you to know that you deserve to be loved and you're a great person for giving a damn about rock and roll. Also, in the description are links to resources like RAIN and the National Suicide Prevention Hotline, both more applicable if you are in the United States. If you need them, they're there. Above all, you must never forget that rock and roll's the best. And so are you.